Alongside Kevin Dahl up front for the Flames, it's Scaldy, Cohn, and Sereau. And Gauthier, wearing number 19, has the puck, moves it for Sereau ahead on the right side. Cohn will race after it. That's swatted away, though, by Mark Watton. And the puck ends up three rows deep behind the Syracuse bench. The coaching matchup tonight, Jack McElhargy for the Crunch, Paul Baxter for the Flames. You can imagine those two crossed paths throughout their illustrious National Hockey League careers.
Certainly, Baxter, or Black Jack, as he's affectionately referred to, were never in too many races for the Lady Bing Trophy as NHL players, that's for sure. So, yes, their paths have crossed in darker alleys than this.
Each team still with its starting six on the ice. Rollison in goal for the Flames, and Mike Fountain for the Crunch, and he moves the puck here along the near boards in his own zone. It's picked up there by Girard. Quickly up ice for Rod Stevens. Stevens cuts into the zone. Quick shot saved by Rollison. Watton along the left wing boards. In behind the net. Stevens is there. The puck rolls up on the mesh. Referee Dan O'Halloran quickly blows the play down, and the faceoff will come up outside the St. John blue line. We've had three stoppages and only 41 seconds gone. There is no score. The goaltending matchup, Rollison for the Flames. Mike Fountain of Syracuse. He's a veteran. 24-year-old. Born in North York, Ontario, 6'1", 176 pounds. He was pulled from the Crunch game Friday night in Rochester after giving up 4 goals on 9 shots. Gave up a couple of quick goals early yesterday to Mario Roberge in Fredericton as the Canadians took a 2-0 lead. But the Crunch came back, and so too did Fountain, wound up as the game's third star with 34 stops. Crunch now back behind their own net. They control. Lead pass for Savenko is off the mark. That should be icing as Bouchard hustles back in his own zone. He gets to the puck first, and the play is blown down.
Interesting there. St. John's showing me something I haven't seen a whole lot of this year. Schulte, Halushko, and Mats in the forward line. No forechecking at all. They lined up one man in the middle, two wingers on the boards. It's pretty tough if you are a defenseman. Sometimes if you have somebody chasing, you know somebody will be open. But in that case, there wasn't a black uniform open at all and forced the Crunch defenseman to ice it. We'll see if that carries on, Aaron, if they're going to press. I'm sure they'll press later on, but right now the Flames seem happy with just flying three across. Call it the offensive zone trap, perhaps.
Halushko on the draw, which he wins, but the puck can't be kept in by Bouchard. Now it's center. Todd Simpson is there. Simpson plays the puck down into the zone. Fountain is out, leaves it there, but there's a penalty behind the play as Brent Tully takes Todd Halushko out of the play. And Mike Fountain, the Syracuse goaltender, thought the penalty was against Halushko, but it's actually Tully who will head off. Tully got his jersey made up for him today, number 34. He had been playing earlier this season, but returning to the Crunch roster tonight.
Todd Halushko just trying to go behind the net, make things happen, as Halushko does. Forrest Tully, play was a long way away from both of them, and Tully yanked him down. That's what Todd Halushko brings to this hockey club, is that pent-up energy. As you said, he hasn't played a lot this year because of that kidney injury, so he certainly had a lot of time to watch enough hockey games. He'll be ecstatic to be back in the lineup.
Tully for interference at 1:09. And it's the Flames who get the game's first power play opportunity. St. John's power play was very effective in the two games this weekend against Fredericton. Coming into tonight's game, the Flames power play ninth in the league. The Crunch penalty killing is pretty good too, fifth overall. Here's Ladislav Cohn into the zone. Quick wrister, rebound for Schulte. He hammers away at it. Fountain is down, and he's able to cover up the puck with his trapper. But a good job there by Ladislav Cohn, who scored on a couple of laser beams past Patrick Labrecque on Saturday night. That time he opted for the wrister, and Schulte nearly forced home the rebound.
Cohn has shown me a lot in the last couple of weeks. He's come alive. He went into that bit of a slump, and then he started scoring. He's a streaky scorer, and he's on that roll right now. But Schulte, a lot of people are saying, well, that trade for Vesa Vitikoski, Vitikoski's lighting it up for Cornwall. It took the kid a while, but I think he's a Flame now. He's really involved, especially in front of the net.
From the draw, the Flames control. Bouncing puck, and Dahl can't keep it alive at the blue line, so he has to retreat to center. Dahl hit there by Scott Walker. Puck comes to Scaldy. He moves into the zone. Quick shot is wide. Bounces far side. Cohn races over there after it. Walker comes up with it, and he plays it back in. Rollison out behind his own net. 2 minutes gone, opening period, no score. Here's Dahl. Skating up ice for St. John. They move from our left to right. Allison near side. Cohn, though, isn't as tall as some players. He tried to jump up to keep that one in play, but it was over his head and into the Syracuse bench with a minute to go in the Flames power play.
Scott Walker, number 55 for Syracuse, been up Vancouver a little bit there last year as well. He's certainly a feisty individual. Him and John Baduk bring the physical presence to the Syracuse lineup. Way Jack McElhargy likes his club to play. So keep your eye on Walker tonight. I'm sure if there's any involvement to be had, he'll be in the center of it.
Baduk had a cameo role yesterday in Fredericton. You can expect when you see number 14 black on the ice, number 2 of the Flames, Rocky Thompson, may quickly jump over the Flames boards. Here's Halushko to center. Into the zone, he gets tied up there with Hussey, and the play is offside. And St. John will have to regroup off the draw. 44 seconds still remain in the minor to Brent Tully. Of course, this is the 40th and final regular season home game for St. John. Wacky Wheatley's TV and stereo fan appreciation night. Someone will drive out of here tonight in a 1996 neon coupe worth about $16,000 and a sellout crowd on hand, 6,153. 14th sellout of the season for the Flames. Of course, playoff packages are already on sale. The Flames hoping to clinch tonight. A real celebration here at Harbor Station. Lead pass for Todd Halushko. He scoops into the zone, puts on the brakes, drops it for Dahl. Back to Halushko, top of the right circle. He moves in, doesn't shoot, holds on to it, loses it. And the crunch, Akhtiabrev moves it ahead on the far side. Lonnie Bohonas gets it there for Stevens. Charging in, his shot, blocker saved by Rollison. And Halushko quickly back the other way for Sirot. Heading down the left side. Sirot winds. Fire saved by Fountain. Puck played far side. Halushko can't keep it in with his gloves. Stevens is there for the crunch. And he'll send it down as the minor to Tully expires. That was the best opportunity. Sirot with the blast from the left side.
And he can unload it too. We've seen that enough. He was in prime position to cock that shot and let it go. Good save by Fountain.
Here's David Struch moving the puck here on the near side. The crunch played away. Jesper Mattsson now gets it for Struch. Struch has it broken up at the Syracuse line. The crunch play it down into St. John territory. Rollison comes out into the corner and plays the puck away from Reggie Savage, who had 4 points yesterday. Brian Loney to the point, shot steered aside by Rollison. Now a shot from a sharp angle. Rollison the save, and he's able to cover up, even though Reggie Savage was right there on the doorstep.
Savage spent a lot of time in the minors, surprising, because when he came up originally from Quebec organization, he was expected to be a force. He was an outstanding junior in the Quebec Major Junior League, and he's bounced around. He's been with Atlanta and loaned to Syracuse. Pretty good impact, as you said, against Fredericton yesterday. Good wheels, has a good shot. Flames certainly have to be wary of him. There's a couple of guys in the Syracuse team. Lonnie Bohonas, who was at the Flames Calgary's training camp a few years ago, outstanding sniper. They let him get away.
He was a leading candidate for Rookie of the Year honors last season until he suffered an untimely injury. There's a lead pass by Sundblad. That could go for icing, but Scaldi's in there using his speed to negate it. He fired it to the slot. No one there, and quickly on the counter, here comes Syracuse, 3-2. Led by Walker. Cross-ice pass. Mark Watton can't control it, and Sundblad is able to break it up for Allison. Quickly ahead for Jesper Mattsson. Mattsson over the line. Makes a move. Now Wade shoots it over the net, and it bounces near side. Mattsson with just one goal in his last 18 games. He has it now in the slot for Bouchard. Shot! And the puck is quickly cleared by the crunch. Here's Bouchard accepting the lead pass from Rollison. Dumps it down into Syracuse territory behind the net for the crunch control. They'll play it out through center. Now racing after it is Savenko, but he's met by Schulte, who steps off the bench. Schulte puts the shoulder into him, knocking Savenko's helmet from his head. And back the other way, here comes Scaldi. Over the line, Scaldi moves in. Shot! Fly. Now Scaldi tried to center it. No one there. Things opening up. Here's Felsner for Syracuse to the St. John line. Dumps it in. Rollison comes out behind the net and gives it there to Todd Simpson. Simpson near side for Cohn, who plays it up ice for Schulte. 5 minutes gone. Opening period. Flames and crunch. Scoreless at Harbor Station. Here's Cohn charging into the zone. Throws it in front, but Schulte couldn't accept the pass. And the crunch will clear it out. Todd Simpson back at his blue line for the Flames, takes a look, steps through a bunch of traffic, gets the puck over the line and in deep. Back there to pick it up is Chris McAllister. He plays it near side. Ian McIntyre along the boards, pounded by Sirot. Puck comes free. Girard out to center, where it's gobbled up by Gauthier. Quickly ahead for Cohn. Shot saved by Fountain. Rebound off the end boards. Bounces on the mesh. And the play is blown down. 5.5 minutes gone. Things opening up. Still looking for the game's first goal.
It's good to see it. Syracuse has not exactly what you call a tight defensive unit. Lanes have been able to, they're keeping a guy high, very high, and been able to sneak him in. We see Cone, Matson, Sorrow all sneak in behind the black. The Syracuse defense getting some quality shots, even though only credited with 4 officially. Fountain's been called on to make some big saves, and of course that Bouchard rocket off the right post. Just wondering, Chris McAllister, they have a basketball thing here between the second and third period. That kid's 6'7", so he certainly got some basketball height. He may want to participate in that promotion.
Win himself some valuable prizes here.
$25,000, I hear.
Parting gifts for the Crunch. This is their only visit of the season to St. John. Here's Kevin Dahl for the Flames in his own zone for Struce. Ahead to David Ling. Haven't seen much of him so far this period. And now for Sorrow into the zone. Sorrow into the slot area, loses it. McIntyre plays it for Girard. He breaks up ice with Stevens. Now back for Girard over the line. That's broken up by Dahl. At center, Robertson plays it back in and got hammered by Sorrow. Robertson never saw him coming, and Sorrow drilled him from the right side. Now Gauthier, pass for Sorrow. Sorrow to center, winds up, fires it in long range. Toe save there by Fountain. Ling along the right wing board, battling in there with McIntyre. Now Stevens comes in to help out, and the puck is controlled by Robertson. He plays it back there along the near boards. McIntyre can't clear. Ling with a good job. Now the Crunch decide to relieve the pressure, and that will go for icing as Jamie Allison is back for the touch.
Right, E. Sorrow had his man head down. You say the hockey's a heads-up game a couple of times, especially Bogdan Savenko coming down. He was on a 3-on-1, and he had no idea if Axon Schulte stepped over the boards on a line change. Savenko thought he was in the clear to start thinking about what am I going to do with this 3-on-1, and then wham, losing the helmet in the process. Pretty heavy hit by Schulte.
Abe Sorrow, number 20 for the Flames, of course, scored his first NHL goal as a member of the Calgary Flames after being acquired on that trade November 25th, along with Craig Ferguson from the Montreal organization. Ferguson has since departed for the LA Kings, playing in the International League. There's McAllister behind his own net, checked off the puck by Matson. It comes to Holushko, top of the circle. Matson on the left side, the drop for Hussey. He moves down low, cuts towards the front of the net. Brister is off the mark, and the puck bounces near side, and the Crunch will clear it to center. Allison controls there for St. John. He moves it quickly up ice for Sundblad. Ahead on the left side, Holushko tried to drop it for Sundblad. Nicholas comes up with it. Scored his first goal since February 25th in the victory on Saturday night at the Aiken Center. Now Bouchard keeps it alive at the left point. Bouchard tied up there along the boards by Savage. They battle for it. Puck comes free. McAllister controls, and the Crunch again content to dump the puck the length of the pond, and it's icing as Simpson is back for the touch. 7 minutes, 22 seconds gone, opening period. There is no score.
You're right about content. That's probably what we're going to see from Syracuse. They just, as you said in the pregame, they need a point here. They may open it up if they think the chance is there. Most of the night, we're probably going to see a lot of lobbing the puck out, get the ice, and just get over center and dump it in. And again, Syracuse is the road team here tonight, so they don't have to impress anybody. Show up and try to get a point. Larry Corville's up here in the press box along with us. Remember him, Flames fan, perhaps from a couple of years ago when he was a rookie with the Moncton Hawks. Had a good playoff series in that 7-game loss to the Hawks that year, and now in the Vancouver system.
Simpson, the shot saved by Fountain. The Crunch come up with it, and Bohonas works it to center. Simpson is there. He flips it back down into Syracuse territory. It's gloved down by the defense. Robinson tries to move it out, but it's played back in by Ladislav Cohn. Robinson in the corner in his own zone, steps out with it, and he'll dump it down, and the fans getting on the Crunch here. Another icing call against Syracuse. It's interesting, the Crunch, scheduling-wise, coming up to this part of the world to wrap up mostly their regular season. They still have 2 games remaining. They'll go back to the States to play them, but they are both road games. They were the first AHL team to finish their home schedule. Syracuse only playing 2 games in the Maritimes, yesterday afternoon at the Aiken Center, tonight here at the Harbor Station, and then they fly back home. Normally teams come up here on marathon 10 or 12 day trips.
Well, they don't have to go to the Cape, PEI, or the Rock, so they're probably pretty happy with this 60 mile stint between St. John and Predator and then head home.
Rollison behind his own net, leaves the puck there for Bouchard. He moves it near side. Cone now back in for Joel Bouchard. A hit on the left side for Schulte. He was awesome the other night in the win over Fredericton. Out to center, Scaldi is knocked down, and the Crunch play it back in. Cohn bumps with Bohonas on the far side. Now Bohonas heads to the bench on a change. Mark Watton off of his bench, and the Crunch captain plays it back in. The Crunch touch up, and Girard gives chase. Scaldi turns away from him in behind the St. John net. Cycles the puck for Cohn. Cohn now moves quickly up ice. The Flames from left to right. Cohn through center, rubbed off the puck as he dumps it into the zone. Watton comes out, plays it far side. Girard moves it ahead. Now Struch can't hit his man, and here come the Crunch. Three against two. Over the line, they're offside as Mark Watton got in just ahead of the play. Watton, McIntyre, and the third man on the rush was Stevens, breaking up ice, but they got confused in the neutral zone and the play went offside.
Scoreless here, 11-16 left in the first, and I'd mentioned that series against Moncton, the Flames. It's unbelievable. It's the 40th and final regular season game here. 3 years have passed already in the history of the St. John Flames organization. About time flying.
You mentioned Larry Corville as well. He was injured yesterday in Syracuse win over Fredericton, colliding with Pierre Sevigny in the neutral zone as they locked knees. Sevigny picked up a major for kneeing. He returned to the game. Corville did not. Out, they say, probably 2 weeks. There's Watton with the puck in his own zone, out to center. Dahl has it for the Flames, and he sends it back in. Fountain is out, leaves the puck there behind the net. And there's David Struch picking up an interference penalty there for hammering into the goaltender and Mark Watton. Struch with two for one there, takes them both out. Struch will head off.
David Struch surprised that he picked up a minor there. The first question off his lips is what? In disgust, but he certainly gets picked up two for charging here. He mowed over his man. Maybe just that interference could have been a call there as well. And Halloran didn't waste a whole lot of time, had the arm up in the St. John veteran in the box. We get first look at Syracuse's power play tonight.
St. John's penalty killing has really improved of late. The Flames are all the way up to fourth in the league on the penalty kill, allowing only 78 power play goals against. They've been shorthanded 450 times this season. Syracuse's power play is abysmal. Just a 15.6% success rate, and that is dead last in the American Hockey League. Halushko, Saroe, Dahl, and Gauthier on the penalty kill for the Flames. So Paul Baxter wasting little time and getting Denny Gauthier out there, thrown to the Wolves, the power play Wolves.
Three of the best Flames penalty killers as well, and LaPointe, Marty Murray, and Cale Hulse are up in Calgary, so guys who normally don't get the work are doing all kinds of it here.
Gauthier in his first pro game knocks the puck down in his own zone. It bounces towards Rollison's net, and the St. John goaltender wisely decides to cover up. With 19 seconds gone in the minor to David Struch, it was a charging call at 9:13. 10 minutes and 28 seconds to go here, opening period. Flames and Syracuse are scoreless. Flames out shooting the Crunch 5-4. St. John will wrap up the regular schedule with four straight road games Wednesday and Friday at the Charlottetown Civic Center against the PEI Senators. Saturday night, they're at the Aiken Center to play the Habs a week from tomorrow at Center 200 to wrap up things against Cape Breton. Here's Stevens battling for the puck in the St. John zone, but the Flames defenseman Joel Bouchard falls on it, and the play is blown down.
Gauthier comes in as well, along with Rocky Thompson, another defenseman, and certainly difficult to come in as a rear guard. He doesn't know Dwayne Rollison at all, so there won't be a whole lot of talking there. They're just going to try to go on both Gauthier, what he knows as a defenseman. So that's the biggest adjustment period, I think, coming up and reading your goaltender, reading your defense partner, Kevin Dahl, who he hasn't seen before. So a big adjustment for rookie defenseman.
Savenko dumps the puck in behind the net. Over there after it is Felsner. He loses it. Simpson moves it to Halushko, and Todd's able to clear ahead for Jared Scaldi. Scaldi with one man to beat, but he gets rubbed out by Savenko. Now gets by him, moves in, hooked down, and there'll be a penalty as Scaldi does a tremendous job there. And he had to be hooked down by Bogdan Savenko, and that's one of the problems of having forwards on the point on the power play. You get that lead pass, Halushko to Scaldi, and Savenko is a forward, not defensive-minded. Thought he had Scaldi rubbed off the play. Scaldi got by him, and Savenko had to hook him down.
A good play right from the start with Todd Halushko. He had a chance to just dump it down, but he had the presence of mind to take a quick look and saw Scaldi open on the right side, and he drilled a pass over. And if there's any Flame you'd rather see on a one-on-one, it would certainly be Jared Scaldi. You bring up a good point with the forward back there. It's a whole different. We're just talking about making the adjustment as a defenseman. It's hard enough when you are a forward. You're used to skating frontwards all the time. You had to turn around. Scaldi's certainly pretty slick with the puck. A lot of good work there to get that shot on goal.
Yeah, tremendous job, because Scaldi had been taken out of the play as Cohn gets a wrister right off the faceoff here. It's corralled by Fountain. The penalty call, Savinko for hooking at 9:55, but full marks there to the St. John captain, because Savinko had put a pretty good hit on him just inside the blue line, and Scaldi managed to stay on his feet and get by him and charged in towards Mike Fountain.
I like the way the Flames have been killing penalties. It's improved a tremendous amount. They're not just content a lot of times with icing the puck. They'll try to make something happen offensively, a sign of good aggressive penalty killing.
Right off the faceoff, Scaldi slides the puck on net, and Fountain is quickly forced to cover up again as we hit the midway point of the opening period. The game is still scoreless. Minute 14 to go in the minor to Struch. Minute 55 to go, and the Savinko penalty.
It's a good try as a centerman every once in a while. Try to catch the other guy, the other pivot, sleeping, poke it through his legs and go in.
Hussey off the faceoff, lines up, pad save, Fountain. Walker comes up with the loose puck, and he skates it to center, knocks it past Hussey down into the zone. Walker dives, and he'll draw a penalty. Horrible call there by Dan O'Halloran, and I don't think he saw it. You could tell that O'Halloran was looking to his left to try and get a good angle, and he missed that one because Hussey didn't even touch the crunch player who dove to the ice.
Oh, as far as even Bill Barber, the king of diving, wouldn't have been too impressed with Walker's bid there. That would get a thumbs down from any Olympic judge. He just kind of bumped in with Hussey, and then you could see, I was just going to say, kind of a poor attempt at a dive. Say O'Halloran, a little late. All he saw was his man down, and sometimes that happens. The referee takes a look around and sees a body on the ice, so something must have happened. And if the puck's not around it, it's an interference penalty, and that's what Hussey gets.
Hussey, of course, spent some time at the recently closed CFB Chatham, and also spent some time growing up in his formative years CFB Gagetown, spent some time in the Oromocto school system. He heads off here for interference at 10-11, so it'll be 4-3 in favor of the Crunch. Halushko, Sundblad, and Bouchard, penalty killers for the Flames, and already we're seeing Todd Halushko get a tremendous amount of ice time on the PK.
Well, he'll certainly inherit Claude Lapointe's work. Does a pretty good job. He's an adequate centerman in terms of face-offs, but he's got that speed. That's the biggest factor.
He loses this one. Walker has it on the far side for Watton. Back to Walker. Watton, top of the right circle, takes a look. Halushko charges over as Watton nearly misplayed it, but he gets it back, works it into the right wing corners for Savage. Now Walker, high slot. Savage is at the front of the net. Bohonas on the left side, controls now in the circle. His shot, save, Rollison. And Dwayne reaches out and pounces on the rebound.
Rollison's going to want to eat anything and everything that's close to his net. Get a whistle, slow this thing down. But I thought the Flames did a pretty good job there. Bouchard particularly. Savage was behind him. When you're down 4-on-3, you can't really worry a whole lot about tying that man up, because in effect, if he had him, allows the puck carry to move in a little closer. So he just kept a shadow on him, made sure he knew where he was, and didn't want to get himself tangled up with the Syracuse forward to take himself right out of the play. So 4-on-3, certainly easier to defend than a 5-on-3, just in sheer number term.
From the draw, Walker comes up with it. He fakes the shot, moves to the high slot, drops it for his captain, Watton. Left side, Bohonas is there. Bohonas cross-ice pass. Walker has it in the right circle. He looks down low. Savage in front. Bohonas shot. Rollison got a piece of it in the puck. Flies over the net. Far side. It's kept alive by Walker. 21 seconds to go in the 4-on-3. Here's Bohonas along the left wing boards. Back to the point area. Walker, the return for Bohonas. Walker now has it, winds up, shot, Rollison the save. Rebound was cleared away by the defense, and the quick whistle by referee Dan O'Halloran plays to the Flames' favor there as the puck was loose at the side of Dwayne Rollison.
Mark Watt not happy with that call at all. He skated in from the point and let O'Halloran know. He thought the whistle was a little quick. The official assuming Rollison had caught that on his blocker. It's good work by Syracuse down low, but they wasted some valuable time. What you'd like to do is get that puck quickly, work it down low, and then all of a sudden a snap pass to your pinching defenseman to get that shot away quick. They'll be looking for the return of David Struch. He's got 10 seconds left. They'll make it a 4-on-4 situation, but the faceoff is inside, still scoreless, 8:57 left. Struch will leave that penalty box in a hurry and get into the defensive zone.
Dan O'Halloran, the referee tonight, the linesman Chris Lee and Chuck McTagg. Oktyabrev from the draw, moves it for Tully. Shot, Rollison, glove save!
Wayne Rollison certainly has been outstanding as a fan's treat him something I haven't heard in a long time, the Rollison chant. He has really turned his game on the latter part. He was, if you remember a few weeks ago, pretty frustrated getting pulled against Portland, but veteran that he is, he's responded in kind. He's got a lot of weight on that shoulders of his. He's done an admirable job, an outstanding job.
Goals against average now down to 2.88, fifth best in the league. Here's the puck in front of the net. Oktyabrev can't get a shot away, and Dahl will come up with it. And Kevin Dahl will clear it to the line. Oktyabrev tries to keep it in, but David Strusch comes up with it. It's four against four now for 25 seconds, and the Crunch will go back on the power play. Strusch is tripped up, and the Crunch come back. Brian Loney into the corner. Loses it. Simpson moves it for Strusch. Ahead for Schulte at center. Schulte mishandles, and the Crunch control. 8 minutes, 14 seconds to go, opening period. No score. Brian Loney, the AHL's man of the year at his own line, controls for the Crunch and flips it ahead. Allison can't knock it down. Felsner wanders into the St. John zone, but Rollison gives it to Schulte. He takes a look. He coughs it up to Felsner at the line. Now Schulte gets it right back. Here's a lead pass for Mattson into the zone. Mattson, one man to beat. Great shot saved by Fountain. And the puck comes to Watton. He coughs it up to Schulte in the slot. Drop for Mattson. Line fighter can't save. Schulte can't get to the rebound as he was tied up by Burt Robertson. Good job there by the Crunch after the big giveaway.
Outstanding work by Robertson. Just took his man down. Schulte had a whole wide open net there to shoot at. His man had him.
Nice play by Schulte to set up Mattson. Schulte couldn't get to the rebound. The way to cover up for your teammates after you cough up the puck in your own zone. Teams are back to full strength for the first time in a while, with 7:20 to play in a scoreless first period. Here's Watton keeping it in at the line, but Ling comes up with it, works it to center, it's picked up by McIntyre, he moves back into the zone offside against Syracuse. St. John Flames Hockey is a presentation of Labatt Blue, proud sponsors of the St. John Flames and Flames Hockey on Fundy Cable and CFBC. Stay with us tonight during the post-game show on radio for the Labatt Blue three-star selections.
It has been a while since Jesper Mattson scored. March 13th, last time he lit the red light, but he's had some chances early here tonight. He is a creative player. He doesn't like to traffic a whole lot, but when he does get the puck in open ice, he can make some good things happen. He wants to break that drought, just keep shooting like he's been doing tonight. Sooner or later, it's going to go in.
And only one hasn't scored since the 13th, and only one in his last 18. That's a little more pressure on a first-round draft pick.
Certainly does.
Here's Bouchard in his own zone. Soreau takes his man down, and Bouchard has some open ice. He steps in behind the net, moves it near side. Dahl races over there after it, kept alive by Savenko. Dahl knocks him to the ice. Now Halushko battling with Bohonas. Puck comes free, and Cohn gives it to Bouchard, who's up with the rush. Here comes Bouchard over the line. He's got Soreau with him. Bouchard to the net, looking for Soreau. Puck loose in front. Soreau crashes into the net. Now Dahl's shot. Fountain makes the save. Miraculous stop with Fountain. Sitting on the ice. The shot came a blast from the point from Dahl, and Fountain caught it.
There was no whistle on the play. Soreau did go crashing into Fountain, but the net stayed on its pegs. The St. John forward trying to get out of the net, and Dahl let it go. The Syracuse goaltender didn't even have a stick. Sitting down, like you said, got the big trapper out and made the save. It made it look rather casual, but certainly if Dahl gets that up a little higher, that might be a goal. Soreau had scrambled out of there. Talk about going to the net. Yves Soreau taking it pretty serious there. Into the net. He's been showing up tonight. So pretty good body checks, making things happen offensively. And with Murray and Lapointe gone now to Calgary, he's got to fill a lot of slack.
From the draw, Mattson, Dahl, shot, scores! Kevin Dahl with the blast from just outside the top of the right circle. Fountain still hasn't seen it. The Flames have a 1-0 lead.
You can always tell when a goaltender hasn't seen it. The hands were up as soon as the puck was in the net. Mike Fountain threw his hands up as to say, there's no way I could see that. St. John created some good traffic in front of the goal. Mattson with a little touch pass back to Dahl, who made up for that miss. He just blew it by the French goaltender there. That's a big goal. St. John's had some good scoring chances and haven't been able to connect. Finally, they do.
St. John Flames' first goal, his fourth goal of the season, scored by number 8, Kevin Dahl. Assist to number 9, David Strusch. Time of the goal, 13 minutes, 28 seconds. Flames 8, Dahl from 9, Strusch at 13:28.
From the faceoff, here's Jesper Mattsson, who will pick up an assist when they review that goal, has it in the left wing corner. Mattsson along the boards, moves it there, gets tied up with referee Dan O'Halloran. Now Brent Tully, the Crunch defenseman, has a hold of Mattsson. Puck comes free, and the Crunch play it to center. Denny Gauthier, the 19-year-old rookie, moves it here for Simpson, and broken up by Robinson. Crunch have defensemen Robinson and Robertson. It's Burt Robertson and Rob Robinson. Be confusing for Black Jack McElhardy. Here's Reggie Savage on the near side. Bumped there by Simpson. Puck comes out to center. Jamie Allison is there and moves it for Jared Scaldi in the neutral zone. Now for Cohn over the line. Broken up. 5 minutes, 37 seconds to go. Opening period. Flames up 1-0 on Kevin Dahl's fourth of the season. Cohn down low in the right wing circle. Cross ice pass for Hussey on the far side. Hussey in front. Schulte shot. As he redirected that shot from the far side, but Fountain was able to make the stop.
Schulte likes the real estate in front of the net. He has made a huge difference to this club. Had been very critical of the team leading into March before the trade about the lack of going to the net. Schulte makes a lot of things happen there. He's got the real estate sign hung out there for rent. Mike Fountain's going to see a lot of 55 tonight. That's all he's going to read. He won't see his face too much because usually Schulte's got his rear end right around the crease area and he's a tough kid to move.
If you heard the game Saturday night from Fredericton or were one of the large St. John contingent in Fredericton, you saw how much time Paxton Schulte spent in front of the Fredericton net and how he got under the skin of his former teammate, Patrick LeBrec. And now here's Rocky Thompson getting his first shift and he starts hammering away at Mark Watton right off the hop. And now Watton wants to drop the gloves and we told you Rocky Thompson would get things started. And now Todd Simpson's in a fight, I believe with John Baduke. Baduke tries to come in with a left hand. Now Simpson's got a few lefts. And Simpson has Baduke twisted around. Simpson coming in with a left that lands on the back of the head. Simpson wants to get some uppercuts in. Now he's just trying to pound on the back of his head. Rocky Thompson wants a piece of somebody. And referee Dan O'Halloran's going to make Thompson leave. And now there's Simpson coming in with some right hands. Baduke can't get any punches landed.
Oh.
And there's a big blast. Now Baduke holding on to Simpson, tries to come in with a left. Now Simpson with a few more lefts, and Simpson doing the bulk of the punching, I should say, here. And now those two heavyweights are broken up. But at what point in the hockey game did I say when John Baduke gets his first shift, Rocky Thompson will too? And that's what happened.
That was a great scrap there by Simpson, and you can tell Thompson wanted a piece of anybody out there. Dan O'Halloran was grabbing the kid, saying, go sit down. So he's going to sit in the penalty box before he actually gets to skate up and down the wing, but certainly Rocky Thompson making an immediate impression, Todd Simpson stepping in. Of course, you know what it's like when John Baduke fights in Syracuse there and they play the old song, Big Bad John. Not have much of a chance to do anything there. Todd Simpson landing some serious right hands. That one on the chin really stunned Syracuse tough guy. We've had a little bit of everything. We've had some scoring, some big hits, pretty good scrap. 5:22 left, and the Flames on Dahl's goal lead 1-0.
Thompson will likely get the extra minor, and then Simpson and Baduke should pick up the fighting majors as Dan O'Halloran smiles as he explains the penalty calls to the respective captains, Scaldi and Watton.
14, John Baduke, 5 minutes for fighting. St. John Flames number 2, Rocky Thompson, 2 minutes for unsportsmanlike conduct. And number 27, Todd Simpson, 5 minutes for fighting. Time of the penalties, 14 minutes, 38 seconds.
So the Crunch will get their third power play opportunity of the hockey game.
Certainly Thompson went out there with pretty much one thing in mind. And as you said earlier, I think even before the game started or when the first chance we got to talk about Rocky Thompson, that when Baduke did peel himself over the boards, Thompson was going to go out looking for him. You have to give the kid credit. 19 years old at a medicine hat. And Section D. He wasn't going out there looking for an unsportsmanlike conduct, I'll guarantee that. He wanted to have a five for fighting, but however, Simpson stepped in. Good call by O'Halloran. He made the right call there, the two majors and one minor.
Thompson was Calgary's third choice in last year's entry draft, 72nd overall. Born in Calgary, Alberta, listed at 6'2", 192 pounds, 166 penalty minutes 3 seasons ago, 220 last year. So he's a tough and rugged customer, but aren't they all from the Western League?
That's Rick Carrier, the former Flames assistant coach. how tough they are in the Western League. He'll let you know. But hey, he is certainly a project, much like Sammy Helena says. Rocky Thompson is still very young. He's not a great skater, but he's one of those guys that will probably play in St. John for 2 or 3 years before getting the call. He has a lot of work to do, but one thing you can't teach is heart, and Rocky Thompson has a lot of that.
Raised a lot of eyebrows here in September at Calgary's training camp, fighting anything and anyone that moved on the ice. And there's Denny Gauthier. There's a kid that knows how to lay a body check, and he just relayed a pretty good one on Bogdan Savenko, who's had a tough night. Oh, now the linesman, Chuck McTagg, took that clearing attempt by the Flames. McTagg down to his knees, quickly back to his feet. That'll be our topic on pass tips tonight during the second intermission. Brian Patafi had to tend to linesman John O'Toole Saturday night in Fredericton. 4 minutes and 44 seconds to go, opening period. Flames lead 1-0. They're shorthanded. And it's Brent Tully at the left point, working the puck in behind the St. John net. Bohonas on the near side loses it. Nicholas Sundblad gets the puck out. Back to get it, Watton. Lead pass, Bohonas at the line. Knocked down by Bouchard, and Ladislav Kohn has all day to play it to center, which he does. Loney is there and moves it for Savage. He flips it near side. Allison hustles back, plays it off the end boards, far side. Kohn is there, gives the puck to Bouchard. Lead pass, Stoney by a short in the breakaway. Stoney moves and shoots, saved by Kohn. Stoney with his own rebound, tried to jam it in, but the puck squirted through the crease. Nice pass, Bouchard, to send Scaldi away. Back the other way, the crunch. Loney into the right wing corner. Met there by Bouchard. Now Girard ties up his man, Reggie Savage. Can't come up with it. Kohn does, and he'll dump it out. Jared Scaldi heads to the bench. Disappointed after that. Missed opportunity, but a tremendous job by Scaldi on the shorthanded breakaway. He's played well here early. Now here's Savage cutting in towards the net. Tried to flip it towards the goal, but Rolison jumped on it and took that scoring opportunity away from Reggie Savage.
Good play by Kevin Dahl, again, the veteran leadership. The puck went through his legs, and instead of worrying about where it was, he just took his man, and Rolison was able to jump on that loose puck. Dahl showing the poise. He knew he had his man, he wasn't going to go anywhere, and he let his goaltender either play it or smother it, and Rolison chose the latter. But Kevin Dahl just taking the man out. You don't have to hammer them all the time. Prevent them from getting in there. 11 seconds left in the St. John penalty.
Walker keeps it in at the line. Walker makes a move around Scaldi. Moves in front, deflected on goal. Rolison with an acrobatic stop as Girard and Savage were right there on the doorstep. And Reggie Savage is a goal scorer. He'll turn 26 on the 1st of May. Savage was a first-round draft pick back in 1988. The Washington Capitals took him 15th overall. He played one game with Washington in his first NHL season and two the following year. But he had 42 goals 1 year with the Baltimore Skipjacks of the AHL. Had 37 in 1992-93 with Baltimore and only 40 games, so he is a sniper.
He's getting up there, so you wonder if he's bound for the minors or not. Washington certainly high hopes for him. However, you have to keep your eye on him. Once a goal scorer, doesn't matter what level you are, he'll go in for you.
He was acquired with defenseman Sean Rivers from the Atlanta Knights. That's where he had been playing at the trading deadline. Rivers suffered a Charlie horse on Friday in Rochester and is a scratch again tonight, as he was yesterday in Fredericton. Teams at full strength with 3:08 to go in the opening period. In that trade, the crunch gave up Matt Rutke, who was an integral part of Albany's Calder Cup drive last season. Here's Savage, or rather Sereau, at center for the Flames. Moves it to Halushko. Halushko loses it. And here comes Stevens, moving down into St. John territory. He fires it through the slot. Sereau on the far side is there. He moves it up ice. Ladislav Kohn has it at center. Kohn over the line. Drops it for Halushko in the right circle. Halushko puts on the brakes. Stays on his feet. In front shot. Found the save. Halushko scores with his own rebound. And a tremendous play by Todd Halushko. What a great individual effort. He was nearly knocked down in the right circle. Got away from that check. Got in front. Initial shot stopped. Halushko scores on his own rebound.
Remember earlier I was saying about Syracuse defense not paying a whole lot of attention to St. John, and Ladislav Kohn was able to sneak in a game behind the crunch defense. They put the puck up to him. He had the presence of mind not to dump it in. He carried it in, dropped it to Halushko initially. wanted to get that pass over to Soro, I think, and all of a sudden there was some ice there. As you said, he got that shot away, got knocked down, got the rebound, put it in.
Goal is 12th of the season, scored by number 13, Todd Helushko. Assist to number 20, Eve Soro. And number 29, Aladislav Cohn. Time of the goal, 17 minutes, 27 seconds.
And the Flames are on top, 2-0. Dahl has the first goal, Helushko has the second. Just over 2 minutes to play here, opening period. So St. John coming out and controlling the play. And we talked about all the good things they build over the weekend, getting 3 of 4 points from Fredericton. They're continuing to build to that block tonight. Reggie Savage looked offside there as he accepts the pass. Play not whistled down and the crunch control in front. Loney on the far side to Walker. Back for Loney. Loney checked there by Gauthier. Puck is within some skates now. Scaldi comes up with it and he dumps it to center. Back there to pick it up is Burt Robertson and he plays it back in. Gauthier for St. John moves it here for Bouchard. Gauthier, of course, was Calgary's first round pick, 8th overall in last year's draft.
Surprised many with that pick as well. People are looking for a forward for Calgary, but he turns out he's one of those guys you drafted. Jim.
Here's Cohn carrying the puck down into Syracuse territory. Top of the left circle. Gauthier watches from the point. Actually, Gauthier's gone to the bench. It's Cohn in there in the corner. Tied up now with Scaldi. Allison and Hussey watch on the point areas. The puck is within a bunch of skates in the corner. Now it comes free. Scaldi bumped there by Loney, who will clear it down, and it will be icing against St. John as Hussey is back to get it with 56 seconds to go in the first.
Syracuse hasn't done a lot right tonight. One thing that they are being allowed to do, or have been allowed to do, excuse me, is they have a winger that's up on the blue line a lot. As soon as Syracuse starts working up ice, one of the crunch players will go to the far boards and stay there. And St. John defense hasn't picked up on that yet. That's allowed the crunch to make a lot of long passes in the neutral zone to that guy standing along the boards, kind of like lurking in the weeds. No major scoring threats really yet, but however, you have to remember that guy is standing over there. Certainly the crunch defense are not scared to pinch in, and that's what's allowing St. John's transition game to catch them flat-footed. There's been a number of 2 and 3-on-1s for St. John.
Gauthier was actually taken 20th overall by Calgary. He's back out there now with Kevin Dahl. The 8th pick overall in last year's draft was young Terry Ryan from St. John's, Newfoundland, picked up by the Montreal Canadiens.
Just signed with Montreal recently.
Likely see him in a Fredericton uniform in the coming years. Here's Akhtiabrev at the right circle in front, all alone, the crunch tied up. Rollison the save, they jam away at it. McIntyre was there at the side of the goal. So too was Girard and Stevens, but Rollison slams the door shut.
You don't want to give up any goals late. St. John dominated this period. 34 seconds left for a shooting. Syracuse 17-11, have a 2-0 lead. Done a lot of things very well. Could have been more, you think of the Scaldi breakaway. Bouchard post, Masson with a couple of bids. St. John doesn't want to yield any goals here. Faceoff coming up to Rollison's left in deep. Scaldi is certainly St. John's best centerman now in terms of faceoffs. Out there for this draw, and he wins that one.
Dahl from the draw with half a minute to go in the period. Flames up 2-0. They move it out to center. Helushko races after it. Back there to play it is Akhtiabrev. He moves it to center. And it's played back down by Bouchard. Now the crunch come up with it again. Moving down the far wing and cutting in towards the net. That's McIntyre. Looks there for Stevens. Stevens had been knocked down in front, and Girard couldn't come up with the puck either. Stevens and Girard, 5'11 and 5'10. Some diminutive, feisty players in there deep for the crunch. Stevens goes at 5'10. Girard has the extra inch as the first period comes to a close. The Flames with a 2-0 lead.
Deservedly so. A lot of times this club has had a lot of shots, which they did this period, firing 17 at found, but they came away with a couple of goals. Could have had more. As we talked about, they had an outstanding weekend, 3 of 4 points, are undefeated in 4, and you wanted to come out the last game of the regular season. Not that it's anything special to these guys in terms of fans. They just want to win every game, and they've come out with a good start here in the opening 20 minutes.
Kevin Dahl and Todd Helushko have scored for St. John. They lead the crunch 2-0. After 20 minutes of play here at Harbour Station, coming up during our first period intermission, we'll be joined by injured Flame forward Ed Ward. That's when we return to Harbour Station. You're listening and watching to Labatt Flames Hockey on Fundy Cable and CFBC. Flames lead the Syracuse Crunch 2-0 after 20 minutes of play, and we are joined by injured Flames forward Ed Ward. Pretty good period for the Flames. Came out and really took it to the Crunch, which is obviously the game plan tonight.
Yeah, they came out really good. You know, we had a day off yesterday, so I thought maybe the guys would come out a little slower, maybe didn't have their legs in the first period, but they seemed to have their legs, and they came out really flying, and very easily could have been 3 or 4 nothing if their goalie hadn't played well.
Yeah, Jared Scaldi had a great opportunity on the shorthanded breakaway, and Fountain, who has been around in this league for a while, stared him down. Scaldi almost had a good opportunity on the rebound, but Fountain is a quality goaltender.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Fountain's been around for quite a number of years, and he's proven that he can play in this league, and he's pretty successful at this level. So, you know, he made a great save on Scalds there, and, you know, he's got to play well for them for the rest of the night, or it's going to be a 5 or 6 nothing game here.
Todd Halushko got an awful lot of ice time in that first period, of course, with Claude Lapointe getting recalled to Calgary just before the game tonight. Halushko is someone you're going to see out there an awful lot when the team is shorthanded, and the Crunch had 2 and a bit of a power play opportunity, 3 officially, and Todd got a lot of ice time and played well.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Todd's just coming back from his injury, and I know the first couple games that he was there, he was struggling a little bit and found that he didn't have his breath on the ice there, but he played a lot that period. He looked really good. You know, he's a strong player, and as you say, he plays power play, he plays penalty kill, and he's a big part of the team here.
I think this team has really built a solid foundation over the last week, starting with that game in Cornwall where the team really played well. Everything seemed to come together that night. You wound up the road trip with a big victory over the Aces when you could have used many excuses if you hadn't won the lengthy road trip that a lot of players on this team hadn't been used to, but played extremely well that night, came back, got the big come-from-behind win over PEI here on a Wednesday night, then the tie against Fredericton, and just a huge victory over the Canadiens on Saturday night.
Yeah, you know, I think as of late, we've really learned a lot. You know, the PEI game, we probably didn't play well enough to win, but we ended up winning that game. And then we came back against Fredericton here in a game that I thought that we played well enough to win, and they snuck a tie out of it. And then we go to Fredericton and beat them 5-0. I think we're showing a lot of character. And this team, you know, we can play, come from behind, we can do whatever it takes. I think we got a real strong team here right now.
Flames leading the Crunch here 2-0 after 20 minutes of play. Aaron Kennedy along with injured Flames forward Ed Ward. When can we expect to see you back in the lineup?
Well, as of now, I'm hoping for Wednesday in PEI, but, you know, nothing's for sure. It all depends on how my shoulder feels, so we're hoping Wednesday. If not Wednesday, I think for sure Friday.
Had to be a tough game to sit and watch Saturday night in Fredericton. That's your style of hockey game, I guess. Gritty in the corners, in your face style of hockey.
It doesn't matter what kind of game it is out there. Any game that you're up in the stands watching is a tough game as far as I'm concerned. You always want to be out there and be a part of it. When you're sitting in the stands, you kind of feel like you're not a part of the team and not a part of the win, and it's a tough feeling, so I always want to be out there playing.
I guess that's something, too, that's an interesting point that you bring up, is because of the fact that the Flames have so many extra bodies around at this time of the year, and not everybody can get into the lineup. The AHL, you only have 16 skaters and 2 goaltenders. In the National Hockey League, you have 2 extra skaters, which makes a big difference. And the positive attitude that you see the players like Jeff Perry and Keith McCambridge, Brett Duncan, who aren't playing as regularly as they would like, but keeping everybody upbeat in the room and still being a part of the team. It's very important. They're traveling with the team, and that's crucial at this time of year.
Yeah, you don't realize how important those players are. You know, I was one of those players up in Calgary for the last 5 weeks, and those are the guys that keep everybody going. You know, they see you working hard after practice, so they go, you know, I got to work hard because these guys are working hard and they want to play, and I'm playing instead of them, so I better perform. So they're a big part of the team, and I'll tell you, if this team's going to go anywhere in playoffs, we're going to use all 27 players. Injuries are going to come around, guys are going to get tired, whatever reason, but we're going to need 25, 27 players to go the whole way in playoffs.
It's really a cliche to say that you control your own destiny, but this team really does right now. In first place is yours for the taking. The Canadiens still lead the division by 2 points over the Flames, the Senators, and the Maple Leafs, but Fredericton, because they only have 2 games left, really can't finish first because the Flames and Senators play each other twice head-to-head. Someone has to gain ground on Fredericton, so the Canadiens aren't going to finish first in the Atlantic, and I know that's where the Flames have wanted to finish. They've been concentrating on that for a while, and it's there for the taking. I mentioned off the top, the brass ring is there. You just have to reach out and grab it.
I think so, and I think the guys are learning that right now. We know that we have to play well every game from here on in, and I think it's important that we build momentum going into the playoffs. You want to win, you know, you want to win your last 3-4 games so that you have that positive feeling in the locker room and out in the ice and confidence on the ice to go into playoffs.
And you don't have to grow as a team at this point in the season. Obviously, that's always there, but having a week on the road, next four games to wrap up the season on the road is a good time to bring everybody together for the playoffs drive.
I think so, too. You know, when you get on the road, you just away from all distractions. You know, nobody has their girlfriends or their wives around. All the guys are pretty much together all the time. Go out for a few beers together. Everybody seems to get out together on the road. And I think it's, you know, it'll be a good road trip for us. We'll win a few games. And, you know, everybody will be together and feeling good.
It seems like this team now has been peaking at the right time. And Paul Baxter told us throughout the season that watch this team in the playoffs. It's defense that wins in the playoffs. The Flames have allowed the fewest goals in the Atlantic Division, and Paul Baxter points to that number, and that's going to be a critical number in the postseason because you don't see 9-8, 10-9 hockey games in the playoffs. It's 3-2, 2-1, maybe 3-1 with an empty netter.
Yeah, you know, all the games or all the series I've played in the playoffs, it always seems that the teams that do well in playoffs are the teams that are getting good goaltending. If your goalie's holding the other team to two or three goals, especially, you know, in the AHL, usually you're going to get four or five goals for your goalie. So I think defense and goaltending is the biggest part of playoff hockey here.
And obviously in St. John, the Flames have one of the top goaltenders, if not the top goaltender in the league. When you look at Dwayne Roloson's stats this year, his goals against average is down to a microscopic 2.88. He's been bringing that down dramatically all season long, and to have it down that low at this point in the season is tremendous. I know that the players were happy to see Roly get that long-anticipated shutout on Saturday night. There have been so many times this year when he deserved and had only given up one goal, but he got the shutout, his first of the season on Saturday night, and obviously this team has just a tremendous amount of confidence in Dwayne Roloson.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Dwayne's a you know, all-star goalie, and he struggled a little bit Friday night against Fredericton, and I'll tell you, I mean, when you struggle, you have a tough game, to come back and shut the same team out the next night shows what kind of goalie he is. And, you know, the team plays with a lot of confidence in front of him. And on top of that, I think, you know, I look at our D core that we have here. I think we're one of the biggest defensive cores that we have in the American Hockey League. And, you know, they move the puck, they're strong, they're physical, and I think that's going to go a long way in playoffs, too.
That's an interesting point you bring up about Roloson, too, where the mental toughness that you have to have, obviously, at this point in the season. And hockey is really one of the only games that you can do that when you look at a key position in football. If a quarterback has a tough Sunday, well, you have to wait a week until your next opportunity. In baseball, a pitcher has a rough outing, he's got to wait 4 or 5 days. But Roloson came back, and he played extremely well on Saturday night. And that may have been overlooked in the fact it was a 5-0 hockey game, but he played very well, especially early when it was back and forth.
Yeah, I mean, he made a lot of big saves. And I even looked at the last couple minutes of the game there when, you know, they had a couple of great opportunities, and he came up with huge saves, you know, to keep the shutout. So it is nice that he was able to come back and play a super game for us on Saturday. And it's nice in that aspect. It's the same with any player. You know, you have a bad game one night, you know, two or three nights later, you can redeem yourself by playing a great game.
We talked earlier about defense and how that wins in the playoffs. Something else, obviously, you have to do to be successful in the playoffs is win on the road. And the Flames have a tremendous road record. If you take away the games at the Aiken Center, you're above 500 on the road, but one of the best road records in the division. And this team seems really confident away from Harbor Station. You're not afraid to go into an enemy building.
Yeah, I don't, you know, for me personally, I don't really care where we play. There's not that many buildings in this league where it's a real big home ice advantage, where the crowd's so loud and so into the game that it makes a big difference. So for myself, it doesn't even matter where we play. I actually prefer playing on the road. I seem to play better on the road for myself. But this team's done really well on the road. And we were just talking about our record against non-Atlantic teams at home, and I mean, it was just horrible against non-Atlantic teams. So we made a real point of it that we wanted to get this game tonight because it was also not only a big game but a non-Atlantic team for us.
Yeah, and certainly as we talked off the top about how this team has been building, this is the game that you really want to win. The Flames have come out here and look very good in the first 20 minutes of play. You can go into this road trip unbeaten in five. You're going to be tied for first place if you win tonight. It may be just tied with Fredericton, or if PEI wins, it could be a three-way tie. It doesn't matter. Tied for first place, no matter how many teams are there, is first place. And this team is really on a big-time upswing heading to the postseason.
Yeah, I think that, you know, this is such a big game because, you know, it's a non-conference game, and the rest of our games are conference games. So this game, you know, ties us for first place if we win. And then we basically control our own destiny there. After that, we play two against PEI. You know, those are going to be the biggest games of the year. Fight. It's basically going to be a fight for first place there, and I think it's a it's a fun time of the year to be playing those types of games.
Ed, thanks for this, and hopefully you'll be back playing these types of games on Wednesday night in Charlottetown.
Great, thanks very much.
Ed Ward, veteran forward of the St. John Flames, suffering from a shoulder injury, hopefully back in the lineup on Wednesday in PEI. Flames lead the Crunch 2-0 after 20 minutes of play. Up next, it's a CFBC Sports Update with Andy LaRue.
St. John, this is Fungi Cable, Community Television.
Adirondack beat Cornwall 3-2 this afternoon. Tonight, Cape Breton and PEI are scoreless. The shots were 17-11 in that first period. Mike Fountain of the Crunch and Rollison for the Flames both played well.
Very good, Fountain. Nice save off Scaldy. Short-handed breakaway a bit. We knew, as you said off the top of this, two quality goaltenders. Rollison the upper hand that frame.
2-0, the Flames lead as the second period begins here. At Harbor Station, Aaron Kennedy along with Brad James on Fundy Cable and Oldies 93 CFBC. The puck down into St. John territory to our right. Kenny Gauthier, the rookie. First round draft pick, 20th overall last year for Calgary, is there, plays it far side. Dahl comes up with it. Ladislav Kohn got hammered along the far boards by Ian McIntyre, and Kohn is down with his face in his hands. And Flames head trainer Brian Patafi sprints from the St. John bench.
Seen a couple of sparrows, early spring sparrows there from Ladislav Kohn. He did kind of go into the boards a little awkwardly on that hit. Looks like the tap's got a towel on his mouth area. Flames winger plays it pretty feisty. A lot of times, not a very big guy, pays the price. He doesn't mind playing the physical game. He's okay, gets up under his own steam. Now he's going to do some last-minute talking. Because the top is still without a glove out there. He's got his right glove.
Right glove is under his arm.
There it is. Right. Matches well with the uniform. Hence the same colors. Good call.
I guess it was under his left arm.
And we're both wearing gloves.
To head over to McAdams in the morning and refill the prescription.
That's right. Leo, can you help me?
25 seconds gone. Second period. Flames up 2-0 over the Crunch here at Harbor Station. Schulte is knocked down. The Crunch control. Gerard's shot is wide. Rollison plays it off the end board. Scoops it up and holds on for a stoppage as Flames head trainer Brian Patafi does some repairs on Ladislav Kohn on the St. John bench. Patafi doing some work there on Kohn, who got hit heavily into the boards on the far side.
What you don't want to hear do here if you're St. John is start this period flat. They're pretty much had that first period the way they wanted to have it. Syracuse with the early jump here. It's only 34 seconds in. You don't want to give the Crunch that early goal. Switch this momentum pendulum at all.
Mattson moves it out to center. Scaldi gives chase. He's tied up by Robertson, and Scaldi is hammered to the ice, and he goes back first into the end boards. And Scaldi had been suffering from a bad back last week. That was interference to the nth degree. No call. Now Scaldi's offside at the Syracuse blue line, and the St. John bench was furious with the non-call there from referee Dan O'Halloran. And if you think back to the interference call that he called on Hussey in the first, that was a blatant penalty that went without a penalty call from the referee.
And in that fight, Simpson and Maduke, I don't think it's the last we're going to see the fist-cup. These guys certainly aren't geographic rivals or divisional rivals or conference rivals, for that matter. Hey, it's late in the year, and there's some guys that are on edge, certainly. Syracuse wants to clinch tonight. St. John wants to clinch tonight. Combination of things can happen both ways. But motion's running pretty high here. A couple of teams that only see each other twice a year.
Yeah, on April 8th, I don't think it matters what teams in the other jersey, as you mentioned. That can be the CH of the Baby Habs or the C and big Crunchman superhero there. Ooh. The Syracuse puck takes a weird bounce off the end boards in the Syracuse zone, but Walker scoops it up, moves it ahead for Loney. Loney into the right wing corner, bumped there by Bouchard. Puck comes free. Simpson comes up with it, slides it far side. Cone is there for St. John. Out to center, sent back the other way by the Crunch. Now Simpson left side for Schulte. Halushko's pass hits Walker in the skate, comes to Simpson. He moves down into the right wing corner behind the net. He's hit heavily there by McAllister. Puck comes free, and the Crunch wheel clear to center. That's Walker moving on the far side and backhanding it down into St. John territory. Halushko pins him against the wall, and the Flames come up with it.
Another dive there by Walker. He's been the best Syracuse player, but he's got to stop making those dives. Too many men, perhaps?
Too many men is the call here against St. John, as the Flames did a good job to stay onside, but then the puck was cleared right in front of the St. John bench, and the play quickly blown down by Dan O'Halloran. So the Flames will be shorthanded for the fourth time in the hockey game on the too many men on the ice call.
You get players playing different positions, like Carlucho's playing center tonight, and yeah, where he's normally a winger, so after this many games, you get used to your man. If Halushko is the man I'm taking, you get used to it. All of a sudden, if he's a centerman, you have two guys perhaps thinking, and that's what usually leads to a little confusion when the players are playing out of position. They come over. Halushko's playing center tonight. Center will usually jump over. Perhaps that winger that usually follows him is thinking that same mentality, and he jumps over, so Flames burn there.
Ling serves the bench minor, which is assessed at 151. That's only the 20th minute in penalties assessed against the St. John bench this season, so they haven't had a lot of those penalty calls this year. 10 minors against the Flames bench. And the Flames, Denny Gauthier back out there on the penalty kill, clears it down. Brent Tully is back behind his own net. Tully takes a look on the near side, moves it ahead there for Stevens. Stevens skates through center into the zone, drops it here on the near side. Felsner is there. Felsner back to the point looking for Watton. He plays it into the far side. Flames break it up. Sundblad will try to clear, and he does. Out to center. Watton steers it there for Bohonas. He loses it near side. There's Scaldi over there to pick it up. Scaldi on the near side throws it back into his own zone for Dahl, who plays it out to center. 2 minutes, 40 seconds gone. Second period. Flames lead 2-0. The goals by Dahl and Halushko. Here's Tully for the Crunch. Ahead on the near side for Felsner. That slides down into the St. John zone, though. Dahl is there, and he'll bank it the length of the ice. Not much happening here on the Syracuse power play. Walker, from his own line, takes a look. Heads up ice. Walker, through traffic, dumps it down in behind the St. John net. Rollison leaves it there for Bouchard. He fires it along the far boards, and down it goes again.
Syracuse is really keeping their forwards high here, and it's forcing the defenseman to get in there. There's not a whole lot of options for passing.
Archer Oktyabrev knocked down by Cone in the neutral zone as the Crunch play it down. Gerard is in there after it. Gerard tied up. Simpson flips the puck to Sundblad on the far side. He's got all day to clear, which he does. 14 seconds to go in the bench minor, served by Ling. 3 minutes and 40 seconds gone in the second. Flames up 2-0. Here's Stevens on the near side. Or rather, Gerard overskates the puck, drops it for Oktyabrev. Nachiabrev fires it back in. Stevens and Girard look like twins, 37 and 38 out there. And as I mentioned earlier, they're only an inch apart in height. Now here's Nachiabrev, met by Ling. He tries to clear, but Walker keeps it in. Shot blocked by Mattson. Ling in the corner comes up with the puck. Ling decides to flip it out through center. And there to knock it down is Stevens. Now Simpson for St. John moves it across for Kevin Dahl. Dahl steps through center, fires it ahead. Mattson, three on one. Mattson in front, can't get a shot away and can't get a pass away as it was broken up by the lone man back, Nachiabrev. Now MacArthur, or McIntyre the other way with a shot. Rolison makes the save. And the play is blown down, but a three-on-one there for the Flames, a busted play.
Three-on-one or two-on-one, any of the, like, when you're outnumbering the defense, you at least have to get a shot. I think Jesper Mattson had too many chances to do things there. Shoot, pass, two options to pass, and nothing happened. Syracuse turned it up quickly. I don't think Rolison was expecting that snapshot by McIntyre. Came over, hit the top of the servo, and let it go. Hit him in the chest and fumbled a rebound. But did cover it. But again, if you have a 3-on-1 or a 2-on-1 or even a 3-on-2 for that matter, anytime it's an on-man situation, you want to at least get a shot. You don't get too many 3-on-1s over the course of a game. That was a clear-cut one from the blue line in, but nothing happened.
Puck in the corner. In St. John territory, it's kicked behind the net. Crunch come up with it in front. Quick shot. Rolison, the save. Rebound is there. Now knocked away by Jamie Allison, who then knocks Stevens to the ice. Now Stevens in the corner, battling for it. Allison watches him. Mattson has his man pinned against the wall, but the crunch come up with it. Out behind the net. The wraparound try by McIntyre. Rolison the save. Mattson hooked down.
Oh, Rolison got away with one there.
Rolison came up and took a crack there at the crunch player who had been right in his face. Now here's Struch over the Syracuse line. He's got some open ice. Backhander, Fountain the save. Rebound in behind the net. Struch is there to pick it up. He's watched by Stevens. Back to the top of the right circle. Hussey, shot, save, rebound cleared by Syracuse. It's on net, though, and icing is waved off. 5.5 minutes gone in the second. Flames up 2-0. Hussey flips it into the zone. Scaldi is in offside. And now Sirot pulls the feet out from underneath the Syracuse player in the corner, and three members of the crunch come in and try and grab a hold of Sirot, and John Paduk is on the ice as well, and Mark Hussey's in charge of holding him back from the fray, which is deep here in the corner in the Syracuse zone. I'm still not sure who it was that Sirot upended. I think it was Stevens.
Mark Hussey and Jamie Allison were at the end of a long shift there, and they went to go to the bench looking for some pine time to get a rest, but all of a sudden this happened, and they had to go on back on the ice and help some teammates there. And instead, Hussey grabbed hold of Paduk. Anything's going to come as a result of this. Lee Sirot has been an effective force for St. John tonight. Certainly he's picked up an assist here as the Flames lead 2-0, 14:30 left in the second. We've seen him go before with a lot of big hits, and that's what he's been doing tonight against Syracuse. Certainly keeping the crunch. They're off their guard or on their guard, looking out for the truck wearing number 20. No penalties as a result of that little skirmish, if you will.
It's only the second time we've seen Paduk all night, and that was briefly, as was his first appearance on the ice, except when he was getting beaten up by Todd Simpson. From the draw in the neutral zone, the crunch, Brent Tully controls on the near side. He plays it ahead. Bouchard tries to break that one up, but here come the crunch. Felsner moves in, waits, shoots, Rolison the save, rebound in front. Barhonis can't get a shot away, and it bounces to the corner. Wayne Rolison staring down Felsner there on what was actually a two-on-one. Tully keeps it in at the line, but the play is blown down on the glove-to-head pass. Brent Tully was a member of Canada's World Junior Hockey Championship team in 1993 and 1994, actually captained the 94 squad that won gold at the World Junior Hockey Championships. He was named the Ontario Hockey League's Humanitarian of the Year in 1994, an award won by Brad Brown of the Fredericton Canadiens last season. Tully was a teammate of Calgary Flame rookie Corey Stillman in junior days in Peterborough.
Peterborough hosting the Memorial Cup this year. They're winning their OHL playoff series. So they want to go in not just as a host club, Canadian Major Junior Championship, but as the OHL Championship club.
Halifax looking to host next year's Memorial Cup. Of course, if they do, they'll be hosting it as a host and not as a Quebec champion. There's Rollison on the far side to Sundblad, who moves up ice. Not to count the Mooseheads out before the season even starts, mind you. There's Simpson down deep into the corner in Syracuse territory. He's tripped up. Felsner's over there after the puck, and it's blown down on a glove-to-head pass. Simpson had little choice but to glove it ahead after he was tripped up, and there was no penalty call. 21-16, the shots here in favor of the Flames. The Crunch went nearly 3 minutes in this period without a shot. And that included a rather porous power play.
Bob McCammon is here helping Jack McQuarrie. He's a scout with Vancouver now, a former NHL coach. He was important last year. I remember that last game of the year where the Flames clinched, and he was kind of going over the, we're just talking about Flames prospects and rosters, and he said, there's one guy on the ice for St. John that'll play in the NHL next year, and he said, Todd Simpson. I was very surprised because Simpson was a free agent and wasn't drafted. Simpson, sure enough, did start the season in Calgary, has an NHL career ahead of him, but McCammon knew right then and there. He knew him from the Western League. He said he'll be in the show next year, and we made good on that prediction for a while anyway.
Here's Gauthier bumping with Savage in the neutral zone as the puck is played down into St. John real estate. Dahl is back there and moves it for Cone. Cone in behind his own net, puts on the binders. Now takes a look. The Flames skate it from right to left. Cone out through center. It's knocked down by Syracuse with a high stick. And the play is blown down, and there's a penalty coming up on the play as well. A high sticking call against St. John, Ladislav Cone.
Cone had started that play. You can see Paul Baxter was making a high sticking sign with his arms, but he just wanted to, the play stopped because of the high stick. Wasn't expecting a penalty. Ladislav Cone's going to go sit for a couple of minutes. Syracuse will be more than happy to try to make amends for that porous power play they had a couple of minutes ago when the Flames were guilty of too many men.
So Cone sits, at 6:54 for high sticking. This is power play number 5 already for the Crunch. And you know, when Paul Baxter looks in a hockey game in terms of keys to victory, keeping the opposition below 5 power play opportunities and below 25 shots.
Except the below 25 shots thus far with 13:02 left. The power play is starting to get a little. Of course, there were two that were just minimal seconds really counted, but however, they do show up on the stat sheet.
Here's Reggie Savage, top of the right circle for Syracuse in St. John territory. Watton in front, his shot redirected by Girard just wide. Walker on the far side into the corner for Girard. The return along the left wing boards. Walker watched by Dahl. Dahl hounds him, puck played into the corner. Girard is there behind the net for Savage. Savage back on the far side. It's controlled by Loney. Back to the point, Walker. He takes a look, gives it to Watton. He banned on his shot. And Halushko plays it in the corner. Walker keeps it alive at the line. Down low into the right wing corner is the captain, a defenseman, Watton. He takes a look. Watton steps here in the near side, drops it to Loney, who mans the right point. Cross ice, Walker the return for Loney. Quick shot is high and gloved by Rollison. And naturally, Loney would prefer to have that shot from just inside the blue line an awful lot lower, say about 3 feet, where there's a chance for a deflection, but no chance there, and Rollison was able to catch it.
Certainly, if you're a forward trying to cause a screen in front of Rollison, you don't want to see those shots coming up around your helmet. Maloney again is a forward and is back on the blue line.
A minute to go in the minor to Cone. Scaldi on the faceoff against Bohonas. And Lonnie Bohonas wins it. Octiabrev in front. Bohonas can't get his shot away as Simpson broke it up. Now Bohonas gets the puck back, and his shot, a backhander, is corralled by Rollison. But Bohonas shaking his head, knowing he should have had a chance the first time. But good job there by Todd Simpson to tie him up in the slot.
That's what Todd Simpson's job is. They've got a couple of snipers on this club, as I said, Bohonas and Savage, guys that know where the back of the net is. You're killing a penalty. You can't really afford to do anything if you wouldn't on a normal 5-on-5 situation with your cross-checking and the like. So you just want to tie your man up as best you can. You did a good job of Bohonas, who knows how to get free. There's 53 seconds left in Cone's penalty. Flames still up 2-0.
Bohonas, never drafted, was in Calgary's camp as a walk-on a few years ago. Signed with the Vancouver organization in May of 94. 34 seconds to go in the Syracuse power play as Brent Tully skates it up ice, moves it here for Stevens in the neutral zone. That's swatted away by Halushko. Hockey Abrev is back and moves it out for Felsner. Felsner comes through center and slides it down into St. John territory. Rollison comes out, plays it there for Simpson. He fires it far side. Scaldi is there. Scaldi moves it for Halushko, two against one. Halushko down the right side with Bouchard. Halushko can't get a shot away. He gets the puck back in behind the net. Now in front looking for Bouchard, but the Crunch come up with it, and they'll move back the other way, lugging it down the far side. Here they come. Felsner into the zone. Tried to drop it for Watton. That's knocked away by Mattson. He races up ice. Cone out of the box, the drop for Bouchard. He couldn't keep it in at the line. He has to wait for Cone to get onside. He dumps it in and heads off. Under 11 minutes to go here in the second as the Crunch decide to ice it. That was a horrendous looking play. Hussey is back for the touch, but we talked earlier about the two-on-one breaks, and Syracuse had a three-on-one, didn't get a shot. Halushko there, two-on-one with Bouchard, didn't get a shot, although it's a different situation when you're shorthanded.
Sure it is, but what he tried to do was, I think he's going to fake the shot and then knife the pass on his backhand, fake with the forehand and get a backhand pass to Bouchard. And when he tried to take the puck from his forehand to his backhand, it skittered away from him. Still, even shorthanded goal can really break a team's back. St. John up 2-0. If that connects and it's 3-0, Syracuse is in deep trouble.
Here's Hussey. Broken up. Out to center. Allison is back to get it. Inside his own line, he goes cross ice for Sirot. Off of his stick, and now here's Girard moving into St. John territory. He's hounded by Allison, and the puck is played out. St. John defense not giving the Crunch a lot here tonight.
Jamie Allison, outstanding back there, making the safe play and the right play.
Now here's David Struess wrestling his man down in the neutral zone as the puck is played in, and David Struess did a similar thing the other night here on Wednesday against PEI. Almost in the exact same spot in the ice surface as he wrestled Darcy Simon to the ice. And tonight he knocks down John Baduk right in front of the St. John bench.
Well, Simpson standing up, but Baduk, no interest in scrapping right now. But Baduk's not the type of individual that's going to hurt you offensively. And Struess gets the gate for roughing there. I'd like to have that one back. And here we've got some action here now. Jamie Allison having words with Baduk. You know Baduk's not going to be out there on the Syracuse power play. He was hanging around the Flames bench long enough, forcing Chuck McTagg, Chris Lee, put on the jets and get over there, keep anything from happening there. But you don't want to keep giving Syracuse, as you mentioned on the last penalty to Cone, you don't want to give them chances. I mean, you're 10-10 left here, St. John's up 2-0, haven't had a whole lot of offense. Flames with just four shots this period. They had to kill. This will be the third time they've been shorthanded. Reiterate again, when you are killing penalties, it's your same guys being used over and over. Some guys, David Ling, not getting a lot of ice lately. It's the same guys, and that tires them out for the third period. Todd Halushko and Jared Scaldi have played a ton tonight, and still got almost half a game left.
Struess for roughing at 9:50. The Crunch back on the power play, trying to get on the scoreboard. Syracuse trails 2-0. 10 minutes gone in the second. Fountain comes out and plays it there in his own zone, and back to pick it up is Brian Loney. He's checked there by Halushko. Watton comes up with it, moves it ahead on the near side. Cruising down into St. John territory is Girard. He sends it across on the far side. Walker in deep behind the net, right wing corner, controlled by Loney. Back to the point, Watton, left circle, Walker. Walker in front, it was off of a stick and wide of the mark. Loney now back to the blue line, Watton for Loney, top of the right circle. Now on the left side, Walker is there, watched by Sundblad. He, Halushko, Dahl, and Gauthier, the penalty killers for St. John. Girard tried to throw it back to the line. That was an awful effort. Nicholas Sundblad, very alertly, just chipped the puck the length of the ice.
Syracuse passing has been atrocious in the last couple of power plays. Nothing connecting at all.
Rollison leaves the puck behind his net. Bouchard plays it far side. Walker keeps it in once. Then Cone moves it out. He's got Scaldi with him. Scaldi down the right side, over the line, in front, looking for Cone. He was hauled down, and there'll be a penalty here against the Crunch as Ladislav Cone, charging for the net, is hooked down, and the Flames are no longer shorthanded as the hooking call is assessed.
Almost looks like the Crunch have no idea what they're doing out there at the man advantage. I mean, that was power play number seven there. Just no rhythm, no rhyme or reason to what they're doing back there. The passes are sporadic and not very often on the tape. they get caught because they just even strength, they like to do a lot of pinching, and they've been buried with some two-on-ones and three-on-twos against. They're caught again there with Scaldi and Cone breaking away.
We're getting a very good indication tonight why the Syracuse power play is 18th in the league. It's only 18th because there are only eight teams. 18 teams. It's been awful. Here's Sereau, four-on-four hockey, as Girard heads off for the hook at 11 minutes. Out to center. Puck controlled by the crunch. Bohonas tried to work it in, but Bouchard locks it and back out to center. Akhtiabrev is there to chase it down. He moves it here on the near side. Tully over the line with a shot that sailed over the net. And it actually bounced onto the mesh, and the play is blown down.
Rolson, I think that was, I was thinking it was a little further off the mark than it was. He kind of waved at it. See the way he reacted. Thinking that was a little closer than I had anticipated, as we see Lushko now coming over the boards with Mattson. Again, Lushko with a lot of ice. Claude Lapointe, because you're just joining us, called up just moments before the warm-up, actually, tonight. Somebody had to gun him out to the airport.
They've got a problem. The crunch are concerned with the gloves on one of the Flames players, I believe. John Baduk looking down, oh, maybe thinking that that shot went off of Dwayne Rollison's glove. Obviously didn't. Bounced off the inboards and then landed on top of the net, so the faceoff comes outside. That's why John Baduk and Black Jack McElhardy were pointing at their wrists. So in 20 seconds, the Flames will have a power play, just their second of the game. Akhtiabrev fires it into the St. John's zone. Back there to get it is Bouchard on the near side. He can't clear. Tully's shot through traffic, corralled by Bouchard on the near side. He steps in behind his own net and waits. Now heads up ice as the Flames are now on a power play. Bouchard through center for Halushko on the near side. He fires it in. That one was blocked by Brent Tully. That hurt. And he plays it out. Flames nearly had too many men on the ice there as they try to get organized on the power play. Here's Halushko at center. Moving up ice. Halushko over the line as Robinson smashes his glass, his stick on the glass, right in front of the Fundy Cable cameraman there, drawing the attention of the fans. Gauthier along the left wing boards for Schulte. Back to the point, Gauthier, wrister save by Fountain, and he'll hold on. Denny Gauthier looking for his first pro goal in his first pro game. He's done well so far tonight.
Yeah, as Paul Baxter, Tom Cullen, Johnson Payton, the kid, just, as you said, just playing with the Drummondville Voltigeurs, and they were eliminated from the Quebec playoffs. Here he is, he's been killing, started the game, first of all, that's a thrill enough, your first pro game, and he's killed some penalties. He's out there with Dahl, the seasoned veteran. You think of relationships like that with the in the NHL, the Bruins, but is in Boston with Kyle MacLaren, paired with Ray Bourque. Dahl's been through the grind, he can say a lot to the kid. Gauthier getting a baptism by fire here. Entering the power play now.
7 minutes, 35 seconds to go. Second period, Flames lead 2-0. The goals, Dahl and Halushko both coming in the first. Here's Scaldi over skating the puck at center. Savage on the near side, met there by Gauthier, and Scaldi comes up with it. Home for Gauthier. Back for Scaldi. Scaldi just outside the St. John line, leaves it there for Dahl. Dahl ahead, over the line, onside is the call, although Cone looked like he may have been in ahead of the play. Cone plays it in behind the net. Scaldi gives it to Cone back on the far side. Cone takes a look, sends it near side. Scaldi is there in front. Schulte can't get a shot away. Now Cone hammers away at it. The defenseman is down and the puck is underneath him. And Robertson is able to hold on for the stoppage as the penalty expires. The teams are back to full strength.
Played by Jared Scaldi there as well. Kevin Dahl was yelling for the puck. Scaldi had it in deep, but he knew the man was coming out of the box. Gerard's minor had expired, so he's going to throw a puck back to the point. Pretty easy for the Syracuse player to pick Dahl's pocket, so St. John Centerman offered to go in the slot instead. Chaos ensued from that little bid. Have a 2-0 here, 6:55 left in the second. Flames owners of a 22-18 shots on goal edge.
6 minutes, 55 seconds left. Dahl and Halushko with the goals, both of which came in the opening period. Flames playing their final home game tonight. They've got four more left, all on the road, two in Charlottetown, one in Fredericton, and one in Sydney against the Oilers to wrap up the season a week from tomorrow. All four of those games first can be heard on CFBC. Syracuse offside here as they can't keep the puck in at the St. John blue line. And we have a stoppage. St. John Flames Hockey is a presentation of the Delta Brunswick Hotel at 39 King Street. The Delta Brunswick is the place where the AHL players stay.
Rocky Thompson out on the ice. John Baduk is out there. I'll give you three good ideas what's about to happen here.
Now they start pushing and shoving right off the bat. They might as well let Chuck McKagg drop the puck. Then they can drop their gloves. Dan O'Halloran, like an irate father, yells at them. And now O'Halloran smiles. He knows they're going to fight. Just a matter of time. Thompson gets his second shift of the game as Baduk gets his third.
How about the crowd chanting Rocky? Second shift for the kid.
They remember training camp. Puck comes in front of the St. John net, though. And those two can't fight yet. Now they still jostle in the neutral zone as Sundblad fires the puck in. Thompson on the near side. Hit by Baduk. Puck comes free. Baduk and Thompson push and shove again. Now they're pushing and shoving like a defensive lineman. Play continues. Jamie Allison in front of the net. Hussey, top of the right circle. Thompson and Baduk are a game in themselves. Puck in front of the Syracuse net. And the crunch will clear. That'll go for icing. Now Thompson decides to take a run at Ian McIntyre. So Thompson heads to the bench and gets a tremendous ovation from the crowd here at Harbor Station as icing is the call against Syracuse.
Kind of fun to see because the Flames really legitimately haven't had a player that is a legitimate heavyweight. A couple of years, you can say, well, Barry Nygaard, but certainly Nygaard's pins, a lot of them are misconduct, if not kid ourselves, with Alex Nikolic perhaps in the first year. And Rocky Thompson, you know what you get with this kid. He is a brawler. He's a Golden Glove champion in Alberta. People say, well, no place in the game. Sure it does. A lot of people watching that, pretty excited, and letting her go.
Absolutely. It's interesting you mentioned about Nygaard last season when he was in pursuit of that American Hockey League penalty minute record. Nykar realized quite quickly that 10-minute misconducts give you more penalties than 5-minute fighting majors.
Add up in a hurry.
Shot from the point. Fountain didn't see it. Just trickle wide of the cage. Ling in there after it, but the crunch will play it out to center and will eagerly await the next shift for Rocky Thompson. Ling for Halushko at the St. John line. Just over 5.5 minutes to go. Second period. Flames up 2-0. Halushko over the line with his shot. That's blocked by McAllister. He has it in the corner, takes a look, shovels it the length of the ice. Icing waved off, though. Crunch again, just dumping the puck down. You wouldn't realize this team's in a position to clinch a playoff berth with the way they've performed so far tonight. On the flip side, the Flames could also be in a position to clinch a playoff berth, and they want it tonight. Coming out of front, Bohonis, wrapper. Rollison makes the save. Now McAllister's shot, pad save, Rollison. That one may have been wide, but Rollison still with a good job to kick out the left leg and kick that one aside. But how tough can that be on a goaltender when you've got a speedster like Bohonis cutting in behind the net? You're not sure if he's going to come out that way. You have to anticipate, and Rollison looked good on that save against Lonnie Bohonis, the sniper who scored his 40th of the season yesterday in Fredericton.
That is a tough play because as a goaltender, you want to hug the post to make sure you don't give that up. Of course, the puck carrier has the advantage. He knows where he's going to go, whether he's going to come right out or go around and put the brakes on and come out the other side. Rollison stuck with Bohonis there. Nice save.
His 19th of the game.
Under five, gone. The left, I should say, in the second. Flames up 2-0. Jared Scaldi controls behind the St. John net. Moves it ahead on the far side, but Cone wasn't there. Walker comes up with it in front. Loney can't redirect it on net. Schulte gets it near side. He'll shovel it ahead for Cone. Cone moves through center, then gets stripped by Loney. Loney heads back the other way. Great job by Schulte to steal that one at the St. John line. Now here's Cone firing it down. I think of Schulte more as an offensive-minded player with his work in front of the opposition net, but he made a nice play there defensively for St. John. Cone into the zone. Back deep, forechecking is Walker. He punches Cone in the face, and that'll draw a crowd in the corner. Now Mark Watton has words there.
Good job by Scaldi to get in there right away. Walker's a tough kid. Not a slap. Cone certainly not pugilistic in nature by any stretch of the imagination. Paxton Schulte in, shoving number 55 for Syracuse out of the fray. Good to see if you're a St. John player. You want your guys sticking up for each other. Dan O'Halloran being a little animated over there in his penalty call.
Well, he came over and said something to Thompson and Baduk when they were jostling on the start of that play earlier. And O'Halloran has been animated tonight.
Some of the off-ice officials were telling me when Thompson was in the box there with Baduk, in the first period that Thompson was yelling across, and we're going to go tonight. So, again, keep the eye on that. So Walker gets a roughing minor for his work on Ladislav Kohn in the St. John zone. And this will be the third power play opportunity of the hockey game for the Flames.
That's where you really want to stick it to a club. There's 4:15 left. You're up 2-0 going on a power play. Shove that third one by Fountain. You see that breathing room, that 3-0 luxury. Hasn't been enough. The first period featured just about a little bit of everything. This period's been pretty slow, methodical. A whole lot of great scoring chances as the fans do the wave here at Harbor Station. Pretty pumped up crowd tonight. This will be the last regular season game before their club goes on the road to finish this campaign. John would certainly like to score here just to get that 3-0 lead going into the third.
And one of these 6,153 fans is going to drive away with a new car at the end of the night.
Look at the standard.
Kohn on the far side in the Syracuse zone as the Flames go to work on the power play with under 4 minutes to go in the second. Here's Gauthier, winds up, shot, scores! First pro goal by Denny Gauthier, and Jared Scully quickly retrieves that puck for Denny Gauthier, a blast from the left point. The kid's got his first, it's 3-0.
That'll make you feel a part of the club, and as we talked about, this kid was a lot of people looking forward to him coming to be here, certainly after the World Juniors. His physical play, his offensive mind, and boys, what a great feeling that must be for him. Get the puck on the point. He kind of actually stumbled a bit, but resurrected himself in time, let it go. Nice low shot, beat Fountain. Big moment from Denny Gauthier.
3-0, St. John leads.
St. John Flames' third goal, a power play goal, his first professional goal, scored by number 19, Denny Gauthier. To number 47, Jared Scaldi. Time of the goal, 16 minutes, 9 seconds.
And the Flames have a 3-0 lead. Rollison leads the puck behind his net for Hussey on the far side. Sundblad is there. Into the corner, Hussey can't come up with it. Sundblad does. Sundblad takes a look. Fires it there on the far side. Kept in. Now Halushko takes a stick in the face by big Chris McAllister. And there will be a penalty call against the rather vertical rear guard.
Certainly not vertically challenged at 6'7". Out of Saskatoon is Chris McAllister, played with Saskatoon Blades, the dub, as they like to call it, the WHL. Not big offensive numbers, 2 goals, 8 assists last year in the Western League.
He was a teammate of St. John backup goaltender Ian Gordon last
right.
year in Saskatoon.
Saskatoon, as Gordon likes to call it, dropped the K in that one. And get her going. The kid was named the Diamond in the Rough Award winner in Saskatoon. Any more Chris McAllister biography notes, you'll have to buy them at the bookstore.
McAllister heads off, 16:27, the time of the penalty. Flames lead 3-0 on Labatt Flames Hockey on CFBC.
Service and value and a whole lot more. We've got it.
We've got it, and you'll want to get it. The exciting 96 Plymouth Neon.
James back at Harbor Station. Todd Halushko takes that high stick in the face, and Chris McAllister heads off for a double minor for high sticking at 16:27. So the Flames, 4 minutes on the power play. That'll run them to the end of the period unless they score a couple of goals. Here's Kevin Dahl back in his own end, and another questionable call by Dan O'Halloran against the goaltender.
Well, I'm going to say even it up right there. That was more than questionable. Seriously questionable, that was. Syracuse player forechecking. Took the dump. Paxton Schulte. Going to get the 8-course. Rollison is tagged as the man. Schulte's going to go over and serve it. Hit that power play in the bud for a couple of minutes.
St. John's Flames penalty number 30, Dwayne Rollison, 2 minutes for interference. Time of the penalty, 16 minutes, 37 seconds. Flames 30, Rollison, interference at 16:37. The penalty will be served by number 55, Paxton Schulte.
Dan O'Halloran seems to be in a cranky mood tonight. If you're with us on television, you just saw him there jawing with the Flames players who were disputing the penalty call. They had good reason to dispute that one. Rolison gets the interference minor. So much for that four-minute power play. It's now four-on-four hockey for 2 minutes. That hurts your power play percentage, too, because that officially counts as a 10-second power play. Here's Watton, bouncing puck, which he can't control at the blue line. He moves back and gets it at center and fires it into St. John territory. Rolison comes out, moves it there for Denny Gauthier, who just scored his first pro goal to give the Flames a 3-0 lead. 3 minutes to play here in the second. There's Scaldi trying to free the puck in his own zone. He gets it for Kevin Dahl. Dahl banks it ahead on the far boards for Cone out through center. Cone is hauled down by Watton. No penalty there from Dan O'Halloran.
Paul Baxter with the wave, the trademark wave, like get out of town wave.
Not waves.
What a hi, how you doing wave.
Yeah, pretty symbolic there. 61-53 at Harbor Station, thinking the same thing. Dahl for Sorot. Sorot loses it. Bohonas in the right wing corner. Can't do anything with the puck. 2:22 to go in the second. 3-0. St. John leads. Bouchard through center. He's tripped up. And quickly back the other way. Here's Scott Walker. But Dahl is back to break that up on what could have been a breakaway from the St. John blue line. Things opening up here. 4-on-4. Sorot lugs it down the left side. Into the zone. His drop scooped up by Walker, who heads back the other way. Ahead for Savage. He's tricky with the puck. Drop for Walker. In behind the net, Savage comes up with it. Looks in front, but Sorot breaks that up. And Bouchard controls. He moves it on the far side. Sundblad is knocked to the ice. And the crunch control at center. Savage lays it back in. Minute 40 to go in the period. Bouchard for Sundblad on the far boards. Now Simpson controls in front of his net. He takes a look. Left side for Bouchard. Up ice. The puck is redirected down the ice by the crunch, so no icing. Syracuse back to play it. Ladislav Cohn's helmet is still on the ice deep in Syracuse territory after he was hauled down on the non-call against Watton.
And John back on his power play now. Last 1:15.
That power play will carry over to the third unless they score. Fountain sends it far side. Hussey tried to keep it in at the line, but he couldn't. Moves back to center and gives it to Allison. Now for Mattson. Halushko comes up with it. Halushko moves into the zone, down the far side. He stops, shoots, blocked neatly, and cleared by the defense. Good job there by Rob Robinson for the crunch. 50 seconds to go.
Halushko, excuse me, has to take his time there. He's got it on the power play. Look around, look for some options instead of just winding it like that.
He steps to center and moves it into the zone. Fountain is out there. Now Watton loses it. Ling getting some power play time to the point. Hussey for Dahl. Left side. Halushko knocked down. Back on his feet behind the net. Mattson. Far side. Ling. Right point. Hussey. He looks. Ling along the right circle. Into the corner. Now behind the net. Mattson comes up with it. Mattson pinned. Halushko now into the left wing corner. He comes up with the puck. 15 seconds to go in the period. Halushko in front. It's kicked out by Fountain. And the crunch wheel try to clear. Dahl keeps it alive. 9 seconds to go in the period. He's stripped by Savage. Halushko now at center as Dahl and Savage have words in the neutral zone. 2.1 seconds to play in the period as the play is blown down. It was frozen right in front of the St. John bench. Savage and now Hussey exchanging words. So the Flames are going to take a 3-0 lead to the dressing room and full marks for that advantage.
Only the second period they slowed it down. I think the Flames sat on it because they ran into some early penalty trouble there. They weren't overly offensive-minded. Certainly looks like they're going to finish with 7 shots on goal this frame against Mike Fountain. Again, take a whole lot of chances on things. Did a tremendous job killing penalties. I thought they won a lot of the battles along the boards. It's going to take them in, as you said, into the third up 3-0. We still got 2.1 seconds left here. This is where the officials don't like it. There's been some scruffing going on. Now you have 2.1 seconds left. Knows what can happen.
Yeah, that can be a lot more exciting in basketball, but not in hockey. As the second period comes to an end, Flames get one goal, the first pro tally by Denny Gauthier. The crunch out shoots St. John 9-7. Flames have a 24-20 advantage through two periods of play, and the Flames have a 3-0 lead. St. John will start the third with a 27-second power play.
Just get it going. What you want to do is just get this game over with. You're up 3-0. Hope things go well in Cape Breton. Oilers lose, and you're on your way to the playoffs. The biggest thing is take care of things first. Win your game. Don't have to worry about what other clubs are doing.
We will have an update from Charlottetown, where the Oilers are playing PEI coming up during...
St. John, this is Fungi Cable, Community Television.
Danny, Evan Dahl, Tom Halusko, and Denny Gauthier have the goals for the Flames, and they do indeed lead 3-0, and they start the third period with a 27-second power play. And the Crunch quickly gets the puck down into St. John territory. Kevin Dahl is back there to scoop it up, and he heads up ice. Dahl through center, loses it. The Crunch come up with it. Walker turns back the other way and fires it down. Both teams looking to clinch a playoff berth with a victory. Flames have the upper hand, and they're 19 and a half minutes away from advancing to the Calder Cup playoffs. Here's Dahl. In behind the St. John net, moves it on the near side. Halusko dumps it back in behind his own net. Sereau gets it on the far side, moves it there for Dahl. Now it's played the length of the ice, and that'll be icing as the Crunch back for the touch. Bert Robertson comes up with it. So this is an interesting situation now for St. John. Should they win this hockey game, and there's very little reason to doubt that they will, up 3-0 with 19 minutes and 17 seconds to play, they will clinch a playoff berth, and they can finish no worse than fourth in the Atlantic Division if Cape Breton does not win tonight in Charlottetown. And that game, as you heard during our second intermission from Kevin Barrett in Charlottetown, is tied at one.
But a little unusual on that last play, Denny Gauthier, the puck was deep in his own zone and he went to the bench. He's hurt. He's now left the St. John bench with Brian Patafi. Skated slowly over to the bench. I didn't see anything happen, whether it's a stick, a puck, or what, but he's gone to the dressing room. The Flames head trainer. Keep an eye on his return.
Schulte has the puck on the far side in the St. John zone. He moves it ahead for Scaldi. He throws it out through center. Cone races down the right side, comes up with it, moves in front of the goal, still has it, can't get a shot away. Now Schulte bumped gingerly into the goaltender, and Schulte tried to hold on to Fountain to keep him from falling. But Fountain went face first, and Schulte rolls over and looks at Dan O'Halloran and says, what was I supposed to do?
Exactly. Schulte had about one half inch between Fountain and the right goal post. He's a big kid, so he's not going to get through there. And he fell on top of the Syracuse goaltender. O'Halloran, not much choice but to make the call. Even though he knows it was probably pure accident. But however, Schulte getting the gate. 18:58 left here in the third. Flames up 3-0. Syracuse, it'll be there. It's eight power play. They're 0 for Sofa.
0 for on the power play and 0 for everything. Goaltender interference is the call against Schulte at 1:02 of the third. And the faceoff also comes outside the Syracuse blue line, where it's controlled by the Crunch. They lug it up ice. Brent Tully met there by Jared Scaldi, and the puck slides back down into the Syracuse zone. There to play it is the Crunch captain, Mark Watton. He skates out through center, plays it across to Tully. He drives it down into the zone. Bohonas on the near side gets it into the corner. The Crunch control. Bohonas on the left wing boards, goes cross ice. Tully shot, glove save, Rollison rebound, loose in front. The Crunch. Felsner has it on the far side. He skates to the top of the circle, drops it to Tully. Back for Felsner, but that's knocked away. Good job by Simpson and Sundblad. Minute 15 to go in the power play. The Crunch play it in. Rollison comes out on the far side, dumps it in behind his own net. Simpson is there, and he'll drive it 200 feet the other way. Fountain moves it ahead to Loney. Loney just onside, steps into the zone. He's met there by Mattson. Puck comes free. Mattson now has it in his skates. Puck comes loose. Halusko knocks it away, and he'll break up ice, but he couldn't get the puck on his stick. Now he's got it with Mattson on a 2-on-1. Mattson back for Halusko, and the pass was just off the mark, and Halusko couldn't accept it and couldn't shoot. Good work there on the penalty kill.
He is the Tasmanian devil, Todd Halusko.
Here's Walker on the near side, in behind the net, far side. Loney has it for Syracuse. Loney in deep along the right wing boards, throws it to the point. Akhtiabrev back for Loney. Akhtiabrev left side, Walker. 20 seconds to go on the power play. A shot saved by Rolison. Dahl tries to freeze it there along the boards. He'll fall on the puck, and he'll get that whistle from referee Dan O'Halloran. But a good job there by Halushko and Mattson on the penalty kill. Just 15 seconds left in that minor against Schulte.
So going, Mattson probably had a chance to shoot there. Halushko did tap the stick on the ice looking for the return. It just got caught in his skate. Couldn't get the shot away. However, that's what speed does to you when you've got Jesper Mattson.
Peter Walsh, the local photographer here, was trying to take a picture of one of the fan appreciation festivities ongoing here, and people were walking in front of the bridge between Peter and the subjects of the photograph, and he was waving his arms feverishly to get them out of there.
Some cackling going on there.
Simpson just got cross-checked from behind by Reggie Savage, and Savage will head off, and Simpson kind of tosses the puck over in Savage's direction. So the Syracuse power play is over with 8 seconds left in the minor to Schulte. So after 8 seconds have expired, the Flames will go to work with the man advantage. Not a smart play by Reggie Savage.
Oh, certainly they're, I think Syracuse becoming a little frustrated. The power play, as I said, that was their, it's 8 power plays, just nothing happened really. Savage a little bit frustrated. He took that frustration out on Todd Simpson with the cross check.
2:53, the time of that minor penalty.
Brian Patafi has returned to the bench. Denny Gauthier has returned as well. He's out on the ice now. It's a good sign for St. John.
4-on-4 hockey until the clock ticks down here to the 16:59 on the board, and now the Flames are on the power play. And it's Schulte right out of the penalty box, moves it ahead on the left side. Ladislav Kohn sweeps into the zone, into the corner. He takes a slash in there deep. Schulte comes up with it behind the net. Puck goes high in the air. They both reach up and try to whack it down with high sticks. Play continues. Scaldi now has it. Scaldi on the far side, shovels it on the near boards, and Kohn controls. Kohn cross ice. Scaldi scores from an impossible angle. Jared Scaldi was on the goal line, and he drilled that one past Mike Fountain. Flames have a power play goal. Ladislav Kohn has 3 assists, and the Flames lead 4-0. Nice pass and a tremendous shot from Scaldi.
Ladislav Kohn was just an outstanding setup. You talk about your seeing eye pass. He was in the faceoff circle. Again, Paxton Schulte making life miserable for Fountain. Kohn put it right on Scaldi's tape. Scaldi looked like he was in a, like, surprised he shot, but he got it away, stuck it in the corner.
St. John Flames, 4th goal, a power play goal, his 26th goal of the season, scored by number 47, Jared Scaldi. Assistant number 29, Ladislav Kohn. Time of the goal, 3 minutes, 27 seconds.
Here's Rocky Thompson back out there on the ice. So's John Baduke. Here comes David Struce down the right wing board. Into the zone. Struce met there by McAllister. Sereau gets it for Struce. The Rocky chant heard through Harbor Station. Struce in the corner. Moves it for Dahl. He sweeps in behind the net. Comes out. Wrap around. Fountain the save. Loose puck in front. But the Crunch come up with it as Thompson now wants to go. But he wants to make sure the Crunch player is going to go with him. And they drop the gloves, and they're wailing away on one another. Rocky Thompson going there with Chris McAllister, and a couple of heavyweights throwing bombs back and forth. Now Thompson comes in with some lefts. That one lands. Now McAllister's throwing his lefts, and they're wailing away on one another. Thompson with a big left hand. Now Thompson comes in with another left. McAllister with the left. They hold on for dear life. Thompson switches to the right. Thompson has knocked McAllister's helmet off. Thompson's is back on the back part of his head. And now the linesmen, McTagg and Lee, intervene. But listen to this crowd.
Standing up.
Wow.
Was that a bout? Two kids right out of the Western Hockey League. You know they've probably seen each other in their travels before. But as entertaining a scrap as you're going to see in the American Hockey League, NHL, IHL, I don't care what level.
They were throwing rockets, bombs, you name it, toe-to-toe.
Okay, Chris McAllister, St. John Flames number two, Rocky Thompson, 5 minutes each for fighting. Time of the penalty is 4 minutes, 6 seconds. Syracuse 28, McAllister, Flames 2, Thompson, 5 each for fighting at 4:06.
There was just that moment's hesitation as each player wanted to make sure the other was willing, ready, and able to go. And once we saw that they were willing, we certainly saw that they were able.
Rocky Thompson showing a penchant for throwing at the left and then the right. You have to think things went into play for him tonight. If Claude Lapointe isn't called up to Calgary, Rocky Thompson may not play. And there was a lot of people didn't think he was going to play at all. He was just down here pretty much to practice, watch, and learn. He's thrown in by Paul Baxter, who likes his players rough and tumble. And Rocky Thompson fits that bill to a T. He's got this crowd stirred up like I can't remember as stirring for that. That was a lot of fun to watch that, bottom line.
How often do you see a crowd anywhere cheering for a player who's playing his first pro game? Not just cheering for him, but calling out his name.
I think St. John Flames have a pretty popular player, and let's face it, St. John's a blue-collar town. How hard is it going to be to market a kid that doesn't mind dropping the gloves and his name is Rocky?
Flames get called there on a glove-to-head pass, which they disputed, but O'Halloran made the correct call. The puck was gloved-to-head from inside the St. John blue line, but Halushko gained possession outside the blue line, and that's not allowed, so the play is blown down. 15:46 to go here in the third. Flames that far away from clinching a playoff berth. All they need to do is win. And they're up 4-0. There's a shot from the point, saved by Rolison. Rebound corralled by Bouchard. On the near side, Robinson works it in deep. Puck comes free, Halushko has it. Halushko tries to get it here in the near side. Mattson is there, he's tied up. Halushko heads up ice. Down the near side, Halushko into the corner, puts on the brakes, holds onto the puck, gives it to Sereau. He winds up, shot, pad, save, fat rebound, kept in at the line by Bouchard. Bouchard down along the right wing board, Sereau checked off the puck. Bouchard keeps it alive. Delayed penalty coming up there against the crunch defenseman in front of the net for whacking the stick away from Todd Halushko. And Robinson will head off. 15:03 to play. It's a festive mood here itself at Harbor Station as the Flames and their fans get set to celebrate a playoff berth.
There is a real buzz in here, which is great. Game, the last game of the regular season. A lot of people who are hyped up, clapping, yelling. Rocky Thompson did quite a salad on him, doesn't he? Him, Mark Hussey, and Todd Simpson with the hairdos of the year. The music's kicking in, the fans are kicking in, doing the wave here, hey. Party time at Harbor Station.
4:57, the time of the minor against Rob Robinson. It's an interference penalty for whacking the stick out of Todd Halushko's hands. So the Flames will go to work on the power play with a 4-0 lead. Dahl, Halushko, Scaldi, and Gauthier with his first as a pro and his first pro game have scored. Now here's Dahl mishandling the puck. Scaldi is getting dragged along the ice there by Walker. Now Scaldi back on his feet, adjusts his helmet as play continues. By Denny Gauthier, hello, as Reggie Savage gets introduced to Mr. Gauthier. Just like a few players at the World Junior Championships remember him, and some in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League. Savage may not know that that was Gauthier yet, he just knows something hit him. Thought it was a Mack truck that came through the end doors at Harbor Station. Gauthier has been very effective for St. John. Crunch seemed to have 5 skaters wandering around out there as they were trying to kill off their penalty. And they are managed to clear the puck down. Rolison gets it to Scaldi, who moves it near side. Bohonis dumps it into the corner. Scaldi is back there to get it.
I have a feeling there's going to be a little more rough stuff before this thing ends.
Cone avoids the check, moves into the zone, winds up, the shot's off of the leg of Watton into the corner. Watton plays it to the line and out. How about Ladislav Cone? 3 helpers tonight, 2 rocket shots for goals on Saturday in Fredericton. And here's Halushko, 2-on-1 with Ling. Halushko backhand, it doesn't get through. Dahl on the near side, top of the right circle, back to the point. Simpson, the return for Dahl. He winds up, shot is just wide on the glove side. 27 seconds to go in the power play. Simpson in the corner. Ling to the point. Saro's shot. That one just missed. This time, Walker side. Now Halushko along the right wing boards into the corner. Ling is there. He flips it far side. Saro is over after it. Tied up by Stevens. To the point. Simpson tees it up. Shot is off of a stick and into the seats. 13-12 to play. Flames up 4-0 on Labatt Flames Hockey on CFBC.
Talk about trust, time after time. You can count on us, mile after mile.
It's part selection and part price, but mostly it's the confidence our customers feel when they deal with our parts people. I guess you could say we're building trust around these parts.
Play just underway as Syracuse clears it down into St. John territory. The minor to Robinson is over and the teams are back to full strength. 13 minutes to go. Mattson at center. Shakes off a check. Now dumps the puck down into the crunch end. Fountain is out. Leaves it there for Robertson. He plays it near side. Paduk is back out there for Syracuse. To say he has played sparingly would be an understatement. Syracuse controls. Oktyabrev up for Girard on the left side. He gets it now for Baduk. That's broken up by Hussey, and Struch gobbles it up at center. Can't get the pass to Sundblad. Now Girard watched along the boards by Watton. Puck comes free, and the play is offside against St. John, and we'll have a faceoff just outside the Syracuse blue line. St. John Flames Hockey is a presentation of St. John Recycling at 390 Rossay Avenue. Together, we can make a difference.
Fourteenth sellout of the year for St. John. 12:24 left here, 4-0 Flames. Played very well, really, winning a lot of the battles. They got the timely scoring. Jared Scaldi's been tremendous tonight. Ladislav Kohn in the role of playmaker. Three helpers, as you mentioned. A little ways to go here, but a lot of Flames with some big nights. Can't forget Dwayne Rollison at the other end of the woods out.
No, we don't want to talk about him at this point in the hockey game. We were talking about him off the air during the intermission, and you probably know why. Bahonis back in his own zone, can't get the puck out. Scaldi jumps on it, backhands it in front. It's knocked down. Schulte tried to turn and shoot, but the crunch play it to the line and out. Under 12 minutes to go. Simpson is back to play it. Ahead here for Scaldi. Scaldi moves it near side. Walker comes up with it. Now Schulte flips it ahead. Cohn has it now for St. John. Plays it here in the near side. Scaldi is there tied up. And out to center it goes. Saro moves it back. Gauthier has it now for the Flames. Down into Syracuse territory. He plays it deep. Back there to get it. Tully pops it up. Scaldi. Watch there, and Loney comes up with it for Syracuse. Quick pass, Savage into the zone. Savage down deep in the left wing corner, behind the net. Another big hit, Gauthier on Savage. Crunch control in front. They can't get a shot away, and St. John will move it up ice. Kevin Dahl. He's watched there by Savage, but Dahl avoided that check, and Savage crashed into the boards in front of the St. John bench.
Savage is hanging really high here this period. He hasn't come in. Meet Mike Fountain in about 20 minutes. Look, he's up on the blue line now.
Now the play is blown down as the puck squirts into the Syracuse bench. You kind of get the impression here that a lot of people at Harbor Station may not realize that the Flames are going to clinch with this victory here tonight, which seems pretty much a foregone conclusion now, as Walker and Ling have words on the far side. A couple of agitators on either side of the ice. David Ling, a rookie, and of course, Walker, who has spent some time in the NHL, played 11 games last year in Vancouver, put up the big pims in the Syracuse last year, 334 in 74 games. But of course, because of all the math and the permutations and combinations with the fact that the fifth place team in one division can get in if they have more points than the fourth place team in the other division, difficult to figure out exactly how things stand, but this is how things stand. Bottom line, the Flames win. They are in the playoffs. So if you're sitting here joining us tonight at Harbor Station, you might want to tell those of people sitting around you that the Flames win this game, they're in the postseason. And you can bet there will be some sort of an announcement to that effect at the end of this game here tonight. The Flames 10 minutes and 52 seconds away from clinching a berth in the Calder Cup playoffs. Game number 76. Last year, of course, they waited to game 80.
Big difference, but however, they waited a little longer than I had anticipated with this club. I thought they would have a playoff spot clinched mid-March. All the talent, but perhaps it is coming together now. We've seen them go in flashes before, but hey, they're playing very well without some key players, and let's not forget that. Artie Murray, Cale Hulse, Claude Lapointe. These guys haven't skipped a beat.
They pounded Fredericton on Saturday night, and they're routing the crunch here 4-0 as Halushko sends the puck down. That will be icing as Brian Loney is back for the touch. Don't forget to stay with us tonight for the post-game show on CFBC. We will have the Pizza Twice game summary. We'll check out the Dominion Refuse garbage goal of the game, and I have some ideas on that. We'll hear the Labatt Blue Three Stars, and we will update the Atlantic Division Chrysler Cup standings for Dobson Chrysler Dodge. And if this score holds, you'll be able to put an X beside the St. John NB name in the Atlantic Division standings. The Flames will move into a tie for first, and they will clinch an American Hockey League playoff berth. 4-0. The Flames lead face-off in St. John territory to the right of Dwayne Rolison, who has stopped all 24 shots sent his way. Crunch. Come up with it. McIntyre shot. Glove save by Rolison.
Rolison hasn't been tested a whole lot from in close, but he's grabbed that one. Listening down. Let's get a draw. Start it all over again. Paul Baxter elects to change his rear guards. Kevin Dahl, then he goes Jay, taking Jamie Allison and Mark Hussey's place. It is going to be interesting to see. The Calgary is obviously in trouble. You've got Roberts and Fleury out there in a dogfight for the playoffs. A lot can depend on what happens here in St. John with what the parent club is doing in the NHL. It's playing tonight, the big game.
Take on the Edmonton Oilers. You can check that out on the boob tube when you head home from this one. Cerro fires it down into the crunch end. Halush goes in there after it. He's played very well tonight. Stevens digs it free and fires it ahead for McIntyre. He heads down the right side, over the line, top of the circle, puts on the brakes, looks in front, Rolison the save, rebound is poked into the corner by the St. John goaltender. Now the Crunch get it back at the line. Shot through traffic, Rolison sees it and hauls it in.
That's the Anaheim Mighty Ducks, or the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, whichever your choice, hot pursuit of Calgary. That eighth and final spot in the Western Conference.
And the Ducks trail the Flames and the Jets by 2 points, with three teams battling for two berths. All three teams have the same number of games remaining, so that'll be about it.
Certainly a couple of crippling blows. I mean, Theron Fleury sitting on the bench and gets a puck from his own teammate that came around the boards, breaks his nose, his eye problems. Gary Roberts, that scary neck. Bad time for the injuries to happen, especially a couple of character guys like that.
Schulte is knocked down in the neutral zone as Struch moves in 2-on-1 shot. Fountain makes the save and Simpson can't get to the rebound. I think it's safe to say, though, that if Calgary does not make the playoffs, the crippling blow was delivered in October when they started the season so horribly.
Oh, sure. I mean, just the fact that the parent Flames are even in a hunt for a playoff spot, I think, is surprising and a testament that Al Coach could get the interim tag off his general manager sign on his desk, taking over for Eisbrow. He's done a tremendous job. He's made some key veteran trades. He's got a lot of use. You remember Calgary last year was rated with a D, I believe, by the Hockey News in terms of prospects. And in the latest edition of that update on prospects, Calgary is second. Certainly they've come a long way, and you look at a lot of the future guys right here in St. John. Just look at the blue line St. John has. It's going to be Calgary's blue line in a year to 3 years. Calgary with all those veterans out there, the Chase Ons, the Lapskis, Patsons of the world.
You can see the anticipation in the eyes of Chris Lee and Chuck McTagg because Rocky Thompson and Chris McAllister are lining up against one another off the faceoff, and they battle here for possession. Thompson knocks McAllister down. Puck is along the boards. It comes free. Simpson takes a whack there at Savenko as McAllister and Thompson now skate away from one another. The Crunch move it up ice. 9 minutes and 15 seconds to play in the game. Savenko tries to split the D. Not a chance as Bouchard and Simpson sandwich him to the ice.
Remember Thompson.
And now Savenko goes after Simpson and gives him a big rough job in the face.
Thompson is normally a defenseman, but he's playing
up front here tonight.
Thompson has a seat on the bench. Scaldi can't come up with the puck to crunch in the slot. Loney tried to spin and shoot. He misfired. And Mattson dumps it to center. The crunch fire it right back in. 4-0, the Flames lead. Bouchard for St. John on the near side. Skates out through center, across the line, into the zone. Drops it. Scaldi, open ice, shoots. Hits the post. The goal is gone. That one appeared to be off the post. Play continues. Walker back the other way, and the crunch offside at the St. John blue line. That one appeared to be directly off the post. The goal light came on, and Fountain waved it off, and there was no signal from referee Dan O'Halloran.
Looks like it did hit the post of Fountain's left. Woljud certainly with a better view than you or I have, which is the way the puck came out.
Certainly looked like it hit the post.
Scaldi's kind of pursuing it with Dan O'Halloran, but pointing to the goal judge now, saying, well, the red light went on, it must have gone on.
So Dan O'Halloran has it announced here at Harbor Station that the puck hit the post and did not enter the net. Of course, there's so much that happens on a goal here at Harbor Station. Yeah. When the home team scores, when that red light comes on, a lot of things go into play.
Are set into motion. Speakers go.
Fred Flintstone starts cheering, yabba dabba doo, and the fans react, and lightning strikes and the thunder rolls. So when it's no goal, it causes a lot of problems.
These officers didn't hit the freeze.
You'd have to throw them back into the crowd to send them back out later. Here's Sereau in behind the defense. Shot just missed. Hussey heads back down into his own zone.
Savage hanging high again. Once again, he hasn't been past his own blue line since this period started.
Now Dwayne Rolston just tackled him and got away with that. Dan O'Halloran's been in a fog all night long. That was a legitimate penalty call against the St. John goaltender and Hussey for hauling Savage down. And now Rolston and Savage push as Mike Fountain, the Syracuse goaltender, tried to shoot the puck into the open net. The length of the ice, that would be the only puck that would go by Rolison to this point, but Fountain hit the post. And now Rolison gave Savage a splash, and now Savage puts the puck in the net, and now the Flames are incensed at Savage. Rolison came in with a bit of a spear there, way away from the play, and Yves Sereau is fired up. But Reggie Savage has spent a lot more time near Dwayne Rolison tonight, certainly than he has towards Mike Fountain, his own goaltender.
Rolison is really fired up. I'm not sure if something happened earlier, because he just did come out to take the puck away from Savage on a dump in. Savage again hanging high. And then he just grabbed, tackled him along with Hussey. As you saw, you could see Rolison look to see where O'Halloran was on that play, and really gave Savage the blade of his stick in the stomach area. Savage is saying, I don't have a problem. I don't know what all the fuss is about.
Well, the only chance these two teams could meet in the Calder Cup playoffs would be in the Calder Cup final. Syracuse, certainly not bound for that, I wouldn't think. But there's a lot of playoff-like animosity here on the board with 8 minutes to play. The Crunch knew with a victory that they could clinch the playoffs. Flames knew as well, so it's almost like a sudden-death game. Someone was going to advance. The Flames are 8 minutes away from clinching that postseason berth.
I've seen Rolison do a lot of that. We've seen him get frustrated in Portland. He allowed a goal, but last year he was a little more abrasive when somebody went around his crease, but he does have that fuse that can become short every once in a while. He doesn't like people in that blue area. He's feisty enough. He's doing a good job making sure things are kept clear there.
So Halloran assesses the penalties. Mark Hussey is in the St. John penalty box. There's no one in the Syracuse box. And I'm not sure what the penalty calls are, but Jamie Allison, I think, was assessed a misconduct. O'Halloran likes to yap at the players, too, and he was yapping at Allison, and Allison was yapping back, and Allison sent him off.
Mark Hussey, 2 minutes for roughing. Number 33, Jamie Allison, a 10-minute misconduct. Time of the penalties, 12 minutes. Flames 5, Hussey, 2 for roughing, 33 Allison, a 10-minute misconduct at 12 minutes.
So you hear the reaction of the crowd here. Jamie Allison wasn't impressed with the misconduct penalty assessed against him. You have to think as a referee, if you're going to be like that and in your face against the players, you have to take a little back.
It's true. Anytime I run into yappy refs, it usually goes two-way street. I don't want to show any lack of respect on either side. But say most officials will put the hand up, and as a player, you pretty much know when to draw the line. If you don't, you'll get tagged, but if you're kind of drawn into it, sure, frustrations boil over, and if he's going to say something derogatory to you and you say it back, well, all of a sudden you're sitting out 10 because you can't give Dan O'Halloran a 10-minute misconduct.
So Allison is done for the night. Hussey will sit for 2 minutes as the clock ticks down towards a St. John victory. 4-0 is the score. Here's Tully as the French go to work on the power play. Bohonis at his own line nearly coughed it up. Halushko was there making things happen again on the penalty kill. Tully now back in behind his own net as the Crunch move in reverse on this power play, which is worst in the league. And we've seen why tonight. McIntyre over the line, down the right side. Rubbed out there by Gauthier, puck in the corner. Kelsner gets it into the left wing corner. Bohonis, top of the left circle. Tully, Bohonis. He tried to go diagonal, top of the right point, but the Flames break that up and clear it to center. Now here's Felsner at center. He takes a look and fires it in. Bouchard is back there to get it, bounces it off the far side. Watton, met there by Cohn, and Halushko chops it down. Back there to get it in his own zone is Tully. He takes a look from behind his own net. Tully is there and leaves it for Savage, who gets a thunderous round of boos here from the faithful at Harbour Station. Crunch fire it in. Stevens on the far side. Watched there by Bouchard. Puck within their skates. Sereau digs it out and dumps her down. 35 seconds to go in the penalty. 6.5 to go in the game. Flames lead 4-0. Here's Oktyabrev on the far side. Walker into the St. John zone for Savage. He's checked by Sundblad. Puck comes free. It's controlled there by Stevens in the corner. He sends it behind the net. Loney races after it near side. Loney was an AHL All-Star. Throws it to the point. Walker in front. Savage, the rebound. He scores. Savage got the first shot on his own, and then he scored on his own rebound. And Dwayne Rollison better get a control of his emotions here, taking some more liberties on Savage, who wound up in the St. John net shortly after the puck. Rollison doesn't want to do anything that would cost him a suspension.
He's hurt.
And Savage took it pretty hard from the St. John goaltender. So Rollison's shutout streak goes for the final 19 minutes and 22 seconds of Friday night's game, through 60 minutes on Saturday, and through 54 minutes and 49 seconds tonight. So over 130 minutes, of shutout time for Rollison.
Savage worked for that goal, certainly. He's taken a lot of abuse tonight. And you're right about Rollison. It's fun, and he had that little meeting with Savage a couple of minutes ago, but you just don't want anything that could end up AHL office or anything ridiculous like that.
Play goal, his sixth goal of the season, scored by number 33, Reggie Savage. Assistant number 17, Brian Loney, and number 55, Scott Walker. Time of the goal, 13 minutes, 49 seconds. Syracuse 33, Savage from 17, Loney, and 55, Walker, a power play goal, 13:49. St. John Flames penalty, number 27, Todd Simpson, 2 minutes for cross-checking. Time of the penalty, 13 minutes, 49 seconds. Flames 27, Simpson cross-checking, 13:49.
So Syracuse's porous power play finally converts, and now they go right back on to the man advantage. And it's Loney from his own line controlling, but he gave it away, and Mattson flips it down into the Syracuse zone. Back there to play it is Oktyabrev. He takes a look from behind Mike Fountain. Now moves it ahead on the far side as the Crunch go from our right to left. Here's Savage streaking through center into the zone. He's knocked down by Scaldi. Savage gets pushed into Rollison again, and this time Rollison does not take advantage of that situation. Now the puck is directed over the glass.
Rollison kind of with his arms up in the air saying, look, I'm not touching him. Stay away from me. Don't call anything. I'm going to figure it out, right? Rollison, 134 minutes and 11 seconds to be exact. Of shutout goaltending. He's less than 6 minutes away. Back-to-back shutouts. If you were listening earlier when we mentioned his name and you said, of course, you know why we're not talking, it's long considered a curse.
We talk about a goaltender's shutout, or he's 6 minutes away from a shutout, or a pitcher's no-hitter with two out in the ninth. Inevitably, it seems it's going to be broken up. I'll just tell Rolison in some interviews tonight that you put the kiss of death on that shutout.
Hey, we never talked about it.
That's true. I'll just say that anyway.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Bohonas dumped it down into the zone. Hussey here on the near side, flips it along the boards. Halushko tries to dig it up, can't. Bohonas comes out in front of the net, loses it. Bouchard can't clear. The crunch keep it alive. This is McIntyre. In behind the net, on the far side. Felsner gets it to the line. Tully dumps it in behind the net. McIntyre here on the near side. McIntyre flips it into the corner. Puck bounces in front of the net, though. Cone gloves it down, can't clear. He'll fall on it along the near boards and hold on. And actually, the Rolison shutout bid was about the only drama remaining in this game. The Flames are going to win. They're going to clinch that playoff berth in the Eastern Conference. And of course, the other drama is for the 6,153 on hand here as they get set to give away that 1996 Neon Coupe.
Too many people leaving tonight. Good marketing boy on behalf of the Flames. One thing I want to see from St. John is how they react. Things are getting a little frustrated out there. Syracuse is taking some liberties. As I'll tell you, when you get into the playoffs, you can't afford to take any extra minors when you shouldn't. Syracuse is going to test St. John's mettle here. I'm anxious to see how the Flames respond to a lot of the garbage stuff here with 4:44 left.
Sunblad on the far side can't get the puck out at the line. Girard works it into the corner. Gauthier with another big hit. Puck bounces in front of Rolison's net. Sunblad on the far side is there. Tries to clear. Robertson keeps it alive. 20 seconds to go on the crunch power play. Baduk is out there. Puck slides near side. Over there to pick it up is Scaldi. Scaldi takes a look in the corner, and he'll air it out.
Give it up, folks!
4 minutes and 15 seconds to play. Dahl, Halushko, Gauthier, and Scaldi for the Flames. Savage for the crunch. St. John leads 4-1. Stevens fires the puck into the St. John zone. Rolison comes out behind the net, leaves it there for Hussey. Hussey takes a look near side, ahead there for Halushko. He gets it to Mattson, and he'll streak up ice. Mattson down the left side, has Halushko charging on net. Halushko got his stick down, and the puck goes just wide on the near side. This is Watton. He comes up with the puck for the crunch, plays it back on the far side. Syracuse will try to clear, and they do. Final from Charlottetown. PEI has beaten the Senators 2-1. PEI has beaten the Oilers, rather, 2-1.
Well, things starting to become a little clearer in the Eastern Conference playoff picture.
Quick shot there, stopped by Fountain.
The skirmishes after the whistle. We're going to have to expect that now. 4-1, St. John up, 3:19 left in the third. And anytime there's a whistle, we can expect a little bit of pushing, shoving, yapping. Syracuse flying out right after this game back home. If you're wondering, the Crunch nickname is from a candy bar company, which owns a percentage of the Syracuse entrant. The Nestle company, actually, owner of the Crunch bar. There's a lot of partners involved with Syracuse, from boxing professionals to the candy bar business. Of course, they play in the arena where the majority of the cult film Slapshot was filmed. Paul Newman and the Hanson brothers and the like.
I wasn't sure if this sheet that had just been passed to me was just poorly written or if it was factual, so I guess that the score was 2-1 in PEI. This is actually a 7. PEI scored 6 goals in the third period and beat Cape Breton 7-1. So the Oilers are in serious disarray and in danger of missing out on this big party that's going to involve 8 teams in the Eastern Conference starting late next week.
Certainly with a club that's future isn't guaranteed there, missing the playoffs for 2 years could be a tough, tough pill to swallow on the island of Cape Breton.
Nice save there by Fountain moments ago, and a big shot by Dahl. Fountain got the blocker on it. Now here's David Ling moving down the right side. The drop for Struce. Struce carries into the corner, throws it in front. Puck is played to the near side. Savage is there to get it. Savage moves down the near side. He's tied up there by Dahl. Savage and Dahl collide. Now Ling trips Savage up at the side of the net. Flames come up with the puck. Now the crunch have it from the point. McAllister shot. Rolison the save. Dahl has the rebound. He moves in behind his own net. Puck comes near side. Struce is there. and he'll backhand it ahead for David Ling. Ling down the near boards into the zone. Ling takes a look, takes a slash, falls, gets it for Schulte. He looks for Struce. Shot! Fountain makes the save. And incidentally, if you're here at Harbor Station, with that final score from PEI, Cape Breton losing, the St. John Flames have now officially clinched a playoff berth. Even before the final 2 minutes and 27 seconds of this game count down, the Oilers can now not catch St. John, so the Flames are in the playoffs. Now, who shall they play?
Well, that's a big question. There's still a bunch of scenarios, and ironically enough, Cape Breton probably going to come into play as the Flames finish their regular season there a week from tomorrow night. Center 200 could come down to St. John playing Fredericton, PEI, St. John's, who knows? St. John, ideally right now, if you're a forecaster, you'd like to finish first. Hope St. John's finishes fourth.
Simpson weaving in the slot area, can't get a shot away. It's going to be a three-way tie for first in the Atlantic Division when all is said and done tonight. Fredericton, PEI, and the Flames, 79 points each. Here's Scaldy in the slot. In front, Sundblad all alone, shoots, scores! And Mike Fountain is fired up, racing after the referee on the far side. But Sundblad had Fountain at his mercy, point blank. Sundblad flips it down for someone who hadn't scored since February 25th. He has goals in his last two games. And the Flames are leading 5-1 in the crunch. Irate.
St. John Flames' fifth goal, his 16th of the season, scored by number 28, Nicholas Sundblad. Assistant number 47, Jared Scaldy. Time of the goal, 17 minutes, 52 seconds.
And the Flames lead it 5-1. Rollison with a save as Syracuse moves in there on net. And now the Flames ice it down. Maxson in a foot race with Robinson trying to negate the icing, but the Syracuse defender gets there first. A minute 43 to go. Flames 5, Syracuse 1. This is Labatt Flames Hockey on CFBC.
Hollywood is here. Meet all the stars right where you want them in the comfort of your own home.
Harbor Station, Aaron Kennedy and Brad James. Glad to have you with us tonight on Fundy Cable and Oldies 93 CFBC. The Flames are 103 seconds away from clinching a berth, and we've got a fight. Ian McIntyre and Rocky Thompson have dropped the gloves. They're ready to go. They're about 3 feet apart right now, and now McIntyre attacks, gets a couple of quick lefts in, but here's Thompson pounding away now with the rights, and he wrestles McIntyre to the ice. And again, listen to this crowd as Pat Benatar belts out, "Hit me with your best shot."
Just waiting to hear somebody yell, "Yo, Adrian." This place has found a new hero. His name is Rocky Thompson.
Thompson won that fight. He won his earlier fight. He's 2-for-2 in pro fights. And he'll get an early shower here. And not a soul has left this rink. Word probably quickly spreading that the Flames are going to clinch a playoff berth, and maybe people want to stick around for the end of this one.
And of course the giveaway doesn't hurt, but certainly this club is going to give its team a nice send-off here. 5-1, minute 40 left. St. John going to the playoffs. Big night.
The other thing to realize is that the Flames are going to finish the season with 4 straight games on the road, and this team has a very, very legitimate shot at first place. They're going to be tied for first with Idle Fredericton and PEI when all is said and done here this evening. This team could easily come back here in just under 2 weeks and open a first-round playoff series.
As long as concerts don't get in the way.
Lippers on a Stallions might have something to do about that, too.
Take it outside.
Minute 22 to go. Flames, Sundblad from his own zone, skates it ahead, has it here on the near side, moves it up by Simpson, gets it at center, gives it to Struch. He sends it in. Baduk is back out there. Has the crunch. Fire it in. Rollison is out behind his net. He has the puck, moves it here near side for Sundblad. Out to center it goes.
Last minute of play in the third period.
Here's Sereau into the zone. Finds Halushko in the slot. Drops Sereau's shot. Fountain didn't see it, but it was wide of the mark.
Halushko is ugly, too. You can just sense it.
Halushko on the far side. In behind the net. Ling battling for it with Akhtiabrev. Puck comes free. Ling in front. Looking there for Bouchard moving in from the point. Puck is caught by Baduk. Halushko gets a stick up high near his chin. Crunch come up with it. Half a minute to play. In the final home game of the regular season, there shall be more in the postseason. Flames on top, 5-1, out shooting the Crunch 32-31 and really controlling this game from the outset. Flames now going to be unbeaten in five as the fans start to celebrate here. Cheering for Dwayne Rollison, and the fans are coming to their feet as the final 6 seconds count down. The Flames win it. 5-1, and it's a standing ovation at Harbor Station as the Flames head to the playoffs. They'll wrap up their regular season with four on the road, but there shall be playoff hockey at Harbor Station. 5-1 is the final.
Well, they have clinched.
And it is a festive mood here at Harbor Station.
It certainly is. It's been a long time since the crowd's been this much into it. Exciting to see St. John. Well deserve it tonight.
5-1 is the final. The Flames win. The Flames clinch at Harbor Station tonight. You're listening to Lobat St. John Flames Hockey on 93 CFBC.